The Pedregons grabbed all the headlines in Las Vegas yesterday. Unfortunately for oldest brother Cruz, the news was all bad. He'll be okay, but the car is junk. For younger brother Tony, he won the pole yesterday and is focused on winning his first funny car title. The NHRA invades Las Vegas for the second time this season. Two championships have already been decided. Two more championships are still up for grabs. One driver has only two more chances to compete in the sport that made her a legend. Race fans, there are only two races left to catch all your favorite NHRA action. And it starts right now. Worldwide leader in sports presents exclusive coverage of the $50 million NHRA Powerade Drag Racing Series. Today, from the Strip at Las Vegas Motor Speedway, it's final elimination for the third running of the AC Delco Las Vegas Nationals. You can see the grandstands are filling in and no chance of rain. Take a look at these weather conditions, 77 degrees, track temperature of 93. We've got four straight hours of action, starting off with Top Fuel. You're going to see every car and bike that goes down this racetrack today. And you got a shot there of Tony Schumacher. Third straight race in a row, he's on the pole. He'll match up against David Baca. Error indicates who has the lane choice. And you can see over on the right side, the number two qualifier, Kenny Bernstein. Larry Dixon in the number six position. First matchup coming out of the box. It's going to be Darrell Russell up against Paul Romine. And Darrell still looking for his first win of 2003. He's up against his old crew chief, Jimmy Walsh, turning the wrenches over on Paul Romine's machine. Hello again, everybody. Marty Reed, along with Mike Dunn, Bill Stevens, Dave Reed, Parker Johnstone. We're so glad you're with us as we're getting ready to go Top Fuel first round here at the AC Delco Las Vegas Nationals. Tire smoke, and who's going to coast to the line first? And it's going to be Darrell Russell. Look at Joe Amato going, woo! We just dodged a bullet.
Joe saying we'll take it any way we can get. And, you know, it's one of those things. I'd rather be lucky than good. Both cars got in trouble early. But like you said, Marty, Darrell Russell was able to coast across the finish line first.
Here's the championship scenario. We've been talking about it a lot this weekend. Tony Pedregon in Funny Car can eliminate Whit Bazemore by just advancing one round farther than Whit. He can do the same to John Force. But if he even makes it to the semifinals and John is still hanging around, well, John's chances are also mathematically over.
And Marty, the car, the crew, everybody is gone except for one man, Tony Pedregon, left to prepare for what is going to be the biggest day of his life, and he's doing it with a little kiss on the box.
Well, thanks to Action Collectibles, they're bringing us another Kiss car, another Kiss theme car. I've been down this road before. I was here last year, same place, same circumstances. One 180 degrees off, we're the ones that are being hunted, and just trying to keep my head, get in my focus. I've been talking about championship, but this thing, in my opinion, is far from over. We're going to pull together as a group. We're going to do what we were doing early in the year. We got the performance of the car back, and if I can do my thing, the rest is destiny, and we believe in ourselves. We believe this team can win a championship.
They want to go out and tear their throats out today.
And, of course, Dave's reference to Kiss is the rock band. In fact, Paul Stanley and Gene Simmons are here. In fact, they were here with us live. I was amazed. They had a concert last night, and they were with us at 9 a.m. Pacific time this morning, and they were awake. And that was more than you and I could say, Mike. Mike?
Yeah, I'm here.
Okay, buddy. Hey, it's time for Jim Head and John Smith in this next matchup, and you see the numbers in qualifying for both drivers. John will be over in the right lane. And for John, he wants to put Jim Head on the trailer because his wife, Rhonda, is 10th in the points right now, and Jim is 11th. And he's got a chance of bumping Rhonda out of there if he can go a few rounds here and at Pomona.
And one interesting note, Marty, is John Smith only made the runs on Friday because he wanted to concentrate on his wife, Rhonda's car, to get her in the show on Saturday, which he wasn't, and only got in on the last qualifying session. So he's only had two runs down this racetrack, but it was a good run. He definitely got a shot at Jim Head, but Jim Head's looked awfully good since Alan Johnson's helping him, and that car's been pretty consistent.
both cars and again a blower belt. We didn't see this much happening yesterday, and the track conditions are not all that bad. 93 degrees on the track temperature, but boy, a lot of action so far in the first two pairs that we didn't expect.
Yeah, let's see if we can tell what happens here with John Smith. You see the cylinder out early, right after he starts to leave the starting line. Then it goes into tire shake and smokes the tires. He backpedals and gets back on it. But look at there. He's got two or three cylinders out, and those blower belts just do not like when that happens, and basically threw the belt off.
We've got to go to commercial break. In fact, there is Gene and Paul, and the Three Stooges are here. Well, look out. World event final eliminations of the third running of the AC Delco Las Vegas Nationals, brought to you by Powerade. AC Delco Automotive Parts, when the right way is the only way. And DirecTV, movies, music, and exclusive sports from the leader in digital satellite entertainment. And there's one of the Luxor Casino views as we take a look at Top Fuel here at Las Vegas and give you an idea about displacement.
Yeah, we always talk about the 500 cubic inch limit on the Top Fuel dragsters, and to get that is to talk about the stroke. The length of the stroke that the piston travels is 4.5 inches. The bore is about 4.187 in order to get that 500 cubic inches on those eight cylinders. Compression ratio about 6.5 to 7.5 to 1, kind of low compression. They want to fill that cylinder full of that nitro to make a lot of horsepower.
And as we come back trackside, it's going to be a matchup of the champions. The Powerade champion, there he is, Larry Dixon, up against the IHRA champ, Clay Milliken. These guys have met five times. Larry's won all of them. And Larry will be over in the left lane for this first round matchup.
You know, and Larry Dixon, you know, they've been trying some things. They've got the champion sewn up. I mean, Dick LeHaye's usually a good test of a racetrack. You know, we've seen some tire smoke in front of them. But I'll tell you, he's also trying, you know, he's thinking ahead. He's also trying a few things for next year. Clay Milliken right there, Mike Clover, they have definitely been struggling. This car doesn't look as good as it did at the end of last year. But don't count them out.
Larry Dixon has won three straight events here at Las Vegas, looking for number four. In 2003 is given to him by Clay Milliken's 462 at 308, and you saw Larry erupt into a ball of flame. So whatever they tried on the Miller Lite car, it didn't work.
Boy, it definitely did. It had good numbers early to 330 foot point. Right about there, the car was making the good run, 217 to that point. But right after that, you see the tires start to spin and put the cylinder out, and then launches the supercharger off and pretty much ends his day right there.
Boy, I got to tell you, what we've seen so far, this could be a day of big surprises, because we haven't expected to see any of what we've seen so far. What's going on with this track?
Well, your guess is as good as mine, Marty. I mean, the track conditions looked good all weekend, but there was a big difference between the nighttime sessions and the daytime sessions. And I think one of the things that the guys maybe are just getting a little bit too aggressive, because normally in the first round, the track's pretty good, but obviously we're seeing that the track is getting a little bit loose out there.
And you get an idea of what the track description is right there, as we're 2,100 feet above sea level here in Las Vegas. Let's check in now with Parker Johnstone.
Well, Marty, crew chief Wayne Dupuy analyzing the data from Darrell Russell's last run, trying to figure out what went wrong. I can give you some insight as to why they went up into smoke. This is the first weekend that this team has used the setback blower, the same blower that's being used on Tony Schumacher's car and the Coletta cars. It gives more evenly distributed fuel flow to the engine, but the problem is you have to reset the entire fuel curve. This team has not made one pass this weekend beyond 4 seconds without going to six cylinders. So Wayne Dupuy hard at work inside the trailer, and Bill, they're hard at work on the car getting it ready for round two.
Well, it's interesting. We've seen three pair of Top Fuel cars so far, and only one has really gotten down the racetrack. Clay Milliken with a 462. What's your secret?
My secret is that was the biggest birthday present I could give Peter Lehman. Yesterday was my anniversary. That's a present for Donna. I used to call her mama, but I can't because she is mama of my kids. And Peter's birthday, it is just awesome. We finally beat the big blue car, you know, champ against champ. That's a big round, but that's just Mike Clover. When guys are having trouble going down the racetrack, he knows how to take that 104 Plus and the Werner Enterprises. Bunch of truck drivers going up down the highway. If they see me wiggling around, they just tell me to grab another gear and keep on going. But there ain't no gears in this puppy. I just stand on the gas and go. But man, what a deal. Matco Tools, Werner Enterprises, Larry Dixon is the champ, you know.
Are you done?
We finally, no, I'm not done. I can keep going.
All right. And you've done a great job, okay.
Thank you very much.
Thanks for talking to us. By the way, a quick note on the track conditions, guys. Because of daylight saving time coming to an end, there's an hour later of sunlight on the racetrack than there was yesterday. That is changing the conditions out there.
Thank you, Bill, as we get ready now for Shirley Muldowney. Her second to last race. And she's up against a guy she beat back at Joliet. That is Corey McLenathan. So far, the lower qualified car has won all three first round matchups. Shirley's number 12, Corey Mack, you see there, number 5. Let's get more on the track. Dave Reif.
And Marty, I had a chance to talk to Alan Johnson, who suggested a couple other reasons for what we've seen so far. First and foremost, he said the air's better today. Cars are making more power. And then he said, because of all of this wind, you know, there's a little bit of dust on the racetrack. And unlike today, previous days, there have been cars down this racetrack that have put the rubber down, got this track nice and groomed. He said to me, it's kind of a green racetrack, so the first few pair of cars are going to struggle a little bit.
Jerry Quinn exhorting his driver to take Shirley out here. I don't know if the fans would be supporting that move. Corey Mack has done it. He puts Shirley on the trailer, 461 at 319. Now, fans, Pomona is her last stop, so get your tickets now because it'll be your last chance to see this legend right here.
Yeah, and Shirley had 0.02 of a second advantage off the starting line over Corey. But unfortunately for her, she lost pretty much in 60 feet. The car was just soft early, and then you see the cylinder start to go out, and that pretty much ended the day because Corey McLenathan was on a very good run in the other lane, a 4.61. You see Shirley lose the belt right there, but that was a great pass by Corey Mack and the rest of that team.
We can guarantee you Scott's going to win the next round when we come back to the AC Delco Las Vegas Nationals. And Clay Milliken's going to be doing a little celebrating after his first round win over Larry Dixon. All right, just a reminder, when we finish here with our first 2 hours of coverage, switch over immediately to ESPN2 for 2 more hours at 7 o'clock Eastern. Final elimination, the AC Delco Las Vegas Nationals. Duck, everybody, the jets are flying over Nellis Air Force Base nearby. For more, log on to ESPN.com. Scott Kalita, as he does his burnout, will go to the far end, check in with Bill.
Well, Corey Mack is going over to shake hands with Shirley Muldowney. She just got out of the car and threw her neck collar at Corey Mack in a little mock derision. But good friends, a couple of veterans here that once again race side by side. You come out on top this time, Corey.
I'll tell you, that's really cool for us. Shirley Muldowney is like one of my idols. So as a kid growing up, seeing the movie, watching her on the track, and just being a snot-nosed kid and then be able to come out here and race her, my hat's off to her and her team for doing this and giving us all the enjoyment she has over the years, and just a great competitor. You know, I'm on the starting line thinking, last time she left on me and drove away from me, so I better do my job.
We'll talk to Shirley.
All right, thanks, Bill. Back at the starting line, Scott Kalita really holds the unofficial title as fastest man in the sport, 333.95 miles an hour at Dallas, was not able to back it up for the national speed mark. There you see his round totals. Of course, he was runner-up at that Dallas event. There is Scott Wise and his qualifying numbers.
And Scott Kalita is the first driver to choose the right-hand lane that has had lane choice. Obviously, they see something they like over there. They made their best qualifying run in that lane, but that was in the Friday night session. Not really comparing apples to apples there, so let's see how this choice works out.
Of this first round, 322 miles an hour. And let's go to Bill again.
Shirley, one more race left to go, but you know, I know you feel good about passing the torch to young drivers like Corey McLenathan that'll carry on.
Oh, well, Corey's been there a while. He can teach anybody a lesson. So, you know, I'll just do my own thing and hope that's good enough.
See you in a couple of weeks.
Bill, it's been exactly 6 minutes since the top fueler of Clay Milliken returned to the pits. They were delayed in getting here as the NHRA officials took a fuel sample at the far end to make sure that they were within the 90% nitro requirement. In these past 6 minutes, the oil catch tank, the rear tires came off, spark plug wiring loom, the spark plugs, valve covers, blower and intake manifold were removed, the clutch rocker bell housing came off, as well as the rocker arms. And as you look at the muscle of part-time top fuel driver Brady Calabota, he's pulling off that left bank cylinder head. These guys will have this thing turned around very, very soon. It's an amazing dance to watch, Mark.
Let's go to Dave Reif for another report as we continue to watch these guys thrash away.
Down with Whit Baseball in the Funny Car Championship, we've talked about the scenarios. You know what you have to do, and simply just get in that race car and go win rounds.
Yeah, and we're not even thinking about the championship right now. We're just focusing on the first round and Tommy Johnson. But we struggled with the car this weekend. We dropped cylinders 3 out of 4 runs. We think we found out why. We fixed it. And if we don't smoke the tires, the Matco Tools Dodge should run pretty good. So we're excited and just trying to focus and do our deal.
And you can see the concentration factor as the butterflies have got to be churning inside both his stomach and Tony Pedregon's. Back at the starting line, you're looking at Doug Kalita in the right lane backing up. How would you like to be Bill Ancona? There's the G. Or that's actually Paul Stanley on the side of Doug Kalita's car. And then how would you like to be this poor guy, Bill Ancona, in his first time he ever qualifies in top fuel? He has to race Larry Dixon. Of course, that's back in Dallas and loses. Now he's got to go up against Doug Kalita.
Well, but the good news is at least he is in the show. And that is because of Larry Meyer. He brought Larry Meyer on board to kind of help out. Larry, I've worked with Larry Meyer on a couple of cars. Actually, when I got my license in Jack Clark's top fuel dragster and also in the 99 Mopar car when we won 4 races and had one of my best years. So Larry Meyer is very, very knowledgeable. And he's very good at running a car on a limited budget that Bill Ancona have.
Well, he tuned Ancona to a career best yesterday, 465, to get him into the show. And it is a 458, 320 miles an hour. As you saw, Ancona have problems, was never really a factor in this one. So Doug Kalita moves into second round, and he will have the lane choice over Corey McLenathan. Stay with us. More top fuel, first round action when we come back to Las Vegas. Back here at the AC Delco Las Vegas Nationals, and you're looking down from the Sanyo Lightship, proud to bring us our aerial views of the racing action and of downtown Las Vegas. The Sanyo Lightship is one of the largest blimps in the world. 165 feet long, 46 feet wide, 55 feet high. Thanks, guys. Glad to have you as always. Let's check in again with Parker Johnstone.
Well, Marty, Corey Mack's top fueler has just arrived in the pits. The jack going underneath the back and the front of the car. The crew starting to work at getting the ballistic blankets off, starting to unpin the valve cover, some of the other necessities that must come off first before they get to the meat of the engine. Let's just sit back and listen.
Yeah, Marty brings back memories working on them top fuel dragsters. I tell you, I was always the guy behind the motor plate, though, doing the clutch, getting all that dirty work stuff, but these guys do a great job here. All of these teams, the amount of work that they do have to go through to get one of these cars ready during the week and all the parts so that they can make these changes in 75 minutes is just amazing.
You know, Mike, what amazes me is how little conversation there is between the crewmen. They've got this tool rack on top of the roll hoop that has all the necessary tools right at hand, but they speak very little during this turnaround, don't they?
Well, yeah, it's pretty much orchestrated. I mean, you know what you have to do. You have your job, and you practice it. You know, I mean, obviously in the qualifying sessions, you have a little bit more time between rounds, so you can take your time a little bit, but get your timing together working with the other guys, because that's the key. You know, you don't want to be walking over another guy and getting in the way. Each guy knows what his job is to do. They orchestrate it, and they get it done, and they get it done very well.
These guys continue to work. Let's go again to the top end. Bill?
Doug Kalita just kissed off Bill Ancona in the first round, and the championship course is a foregone conclusion right now, but this is going to be a good opportunity in the last two races. You guys get a springboard for next season.
Yeah, we're real excited here with Kiss. You know, they're great to have out here, and it's great for the sport. So, you know, we're just trying to go around, see if we can get the win here. You know, it'd be great to finish the year out strong, and Mack Tools and everybody that's supporting this thing, Technicode, it's all good. So we're trying our hardest.
Forgot your face paint.
Back in the staging lanes with the 12-time Funny Car Champ, John Flores, will not get Championship 13 this year. And that's kind of getting lost a little bit over your teammate.
Well, yeah, it was kind of funny. We were in a meeting this morning with Roger Staal and everybody and talking about the KISS group and the Three Stooges with the Action Collectible. And everyone said, okay, it's time to pray. And under the pressure, as always, to win a championship and for Tony to get this. And bottom line, I said, but did anybody think that I lost it? It was never even mentioned in the meeting. But we're excited for this team to watch this fight with Bazemore, and we'll see what happens.
Don't forget, he can still chase down second.
That's right. He's only 62 points behind as you look at Kenny Bernstein. Also looking at his second to last race, because remember, Brandon Bernstein is coming back to this car next year. And so the extended Forever Red Tour is just about to end. Kenny will be alongside Aronda Hartman-Smith in this first-round matchup. Let's check in first with Parker.
Doug Paletta's fueler not even off the tow line, and the guys already attack it before they've got it lined up and pushed into the pit. You can see they're hard at work at the top end of the car, trying to get it pulled back into position. When you've got a 300-inch wheelbase, you can't just make a perfect three-point turn every single time. But you can see the work starts before the car's even in the pits.
Yeah, there's not a lot of shopping mall spots that this thing will fit into. Back track side, you can see Kenny's numbers, and boy, he's had some good runs, 3 out of 4 times down the track.
Yeah, Kenny Bernstein's looked very, very good here this weekend. Both him and Tim Richards have had some good races here in Las Vegas, obviously, but they look very, very good in qualifying. Like you said, Marty, down that racetrack every run. Rhonda Hartman, she's been struggling. I mean, we know this car's capable. It has 450 horsepower, but they just can't hit it. But Kenny Bernstein can't take her for granted, because if they do hit that combination, he knows he's got to go down the track if he wants to have a shot at beating her.
Rhonda, with Doug Herbert failing to qualify, she could move ahead of him in the points if she can go enough rounds. Tim Richards, well, he and Kenny, they've won 2 spring races here. In fact, they doubled up. Remember when Brandon won in alcohol the same day Kenny won in Top Fuel? It has never happened before. He definitely likes this place. And he's going to like it again. 459 at 324 miles an hour, and that's going to give him lane choice over Rhonda's husband, John Smith. So, as we head for commercial break, it will be the number one qualifier, Tony Schumacher, and David Baca has the job of trying to punch out one of the quickest cars all weekend long. There, the work continues. Playmakers continues Tuesday. One of the teammates is gay. Will the Krugers band together or come apart? Playmakers Tuesday, 9 Eastern on ESPN. It's also available on high definition on ESPN HD. Call your cable operator, DirecTV, or the Dish Network today. For more, log on to ESPN.com. Back here at the AC Delco Las Vegas Nationals at the Strip at Las Vegas Motor Speedway, I'm Marty Reid, along with Mike Dunn, Bill Stevens, Dave Reid, Parker Johnstone, and so far in the first round of Top Fuel, Larry Dixon loses for the first time in first round in 2003 to that man right there, Clay Milliken, the IHRA champion, and these guys thrashing like crazy, getting ready for their second round matchup. Back at the starting line, you're looking at the number one qualifier for the third straight race, Tony Schumacher, and the man who is trying to become Rookie of the Year, David Baca. His biggest competition, Brandon Bernstein, and there are the numbers. And you and Bill sort of went at odds in our staging duel, if everybody was with us earlier today.
Well, I think it just should be similar to the Powerade Points Championship. It's not necessarily the guy that wins the most races. It's the one that's most consistent. David Baca, obviously, by being able to run all the races, he's been very consistent. Even though he's coming in here, Marty, in the number 16 qualifier, you can't go by those numbers, because yesterday he was on a very good run, probably going to run about a mid-450 run before they broke the crank. So Tony Schumacher, even though he's been the class of the field all weekend, cannot take David Baca lightly.
Schumacher has been quickest in all 4 previous qualifying sessions. See from the Sanyo light chip, not a factor. It's Tony all the way, 462 to a 466. Baca have a little bit of flame right at the top end.
Yeah, this was a good old drag race. I would have expected a little bit more, but look right there. You see the cylinder out on Tony Schumacher's car shortly after he left the starting line. Still runs a 4.62. Luckily for him, that was better than David Baca's 4.66, and he's into the next round.
So take a look in the matchup with the Schumacher and Doug Kalita getting lane choice on the left side. Over on the right, Kenny Bernstein and Scott Kalita. And when we come back, we'll take a look at Larry Dixon and his family and a unique perspective that he has on life and drag racing. Stay with us. Hey, just a reminder, when we close out here at 7 o'clock Eastern Time, just switch over to ESPN2 because we've got two more hours of final eliminations here at the AC Delco Las Vegas Nationals. For more, log on to ESPN.com. Now, 2 weeks ago in Dallas, two champions were crowned. Greg Anderson scored his first pro stock title, and Larry Dixon captured his second straight Powerade Top Fuel Championship. We asked the team members from each what the championship meant to them. First up, the Anderson squad.
The 2003 Powerade Pro Stock Champions. It's just incredible, the sound of it and what it really means. So I'm living my life right now, you know, at its fullest.
I was on Winston Cup teams that won, and that was, you know, a huge deal to me also. But Pro Stock's kind of always been my first love, so it was probably a bigger deal to me to win this.
It's a dream a guy's had ever since he was a kid, bragging racing. And growing up in the sportsman ranks, racing with my father, I can't even believe that I have an opportunity to work on a Pro Stock team, let alone win a championship.
It's the only thing I've ever tried to achieve. I never did anything else. It's all I've ever done is motorsports.
I'm really excited about it now, but I'm more excited for my team. So I'm more excited for them than for myself. This is great. It's amazing how many new friends I have this week, and especially being in my hometown, you know, and that. But, so it's really been fun. It's exciting, to say the least. Even if I don't show much emotion, I'm really happy.
I'm really proud of our team, that we were able to stay focused and just keep doing the things that got us in the position, you know, from last year to this year.
Pretty proud, you know, that I've accomplished some of the goals that I set out to achieve, and part of a winning team, that's always a good feeling.
It's a level of accomplishment that, you know, sometimes I'm even a hero with my friends back home, you know, so that's pretty cool.
I've just been really fortunate. I've only been with the team for 2 years and two championships, so obviously on my end of it, I feel like super spoiled. I mean, there's been guys out here for 15, 20 years and even longer that have never even, you know, been even close to winning a championship.
It's a great feeling to know that you worked hard and they have faith in you and everything you do, and it all works together and all, and the end comes out, you know, on top.
Just really excited that, you know, it's over, but you know, we want to move on, get ready for next year. You know, it's a phenomenal feeling, just hard to believe.
Well, there's still some unfinished business for both these guys. Even though Larry Dixon lost in first round, he can still exceed the win record for rounds in a season. So can Greg Anderson. And he can tie the mark for most wins in a season. Of course, Greg can break the record if he can win today and again in 2 weeks in Pomona. So both these guys have something to shoot for still, even though they've clinched the championships. Now, as most involved with this great sport of drag racing will attest, it can be all-consuming. Larry Dixon and his wife, Allie, explained how Larry proposed and managed to put family first.
I had the ring, and she didn't know, and I had it tucked in my sock, because she liked go in my pockets all the time and didn't want her to find it. And it was getting close to New Year's Eve and wanted to do it right then. So I had to go to, you know, like, it's like a minute before and I'm like, I gotta go to the bathroom. And she's like, why? You know, it's like New Year's Eve, wait. And then like took her in a room and sitting down, got on one knee. And did you ever say yes?
I don't think so.
I don't think you did.
I was getting my license when I met Larry. We were gonna get a sportsman car and I was gonna race it at the national events, and he was gonna do it at like points meets and that, and then along came Donovan.
Okay, scarred for some.
Gonna have the baby on board sticker.
You know, when you're at the races and you're at the racetrack and you're racing somebody, I mean, that at the moment it's very real. But then when it's all done, everybody goes home, you know, this is
This is the stuff that counts.
Here, here, wait, wait, show him how Dad makes it go away.
Hey, where,
show, go away,
okay.
Go away.
Hey, show me, show me, show me. Okay, right there, right there. Okay, stop crying, otherwise it don't work. Hang on. Okay, stop, stop.
Oh.
It was racing. It was all consuming. It was, I don't know.
It's not the end of the world anymore.
It's not the end of the world anymore. That would be a good way to put it. This is my priorities. You race, you win, you lose. At the end of the day, you go home. But, you know, these are the guys that it makes the difference.
Great family. Hey, when we come back, the championship continues between Whit and Tony. Stay with us. One of the great things about being here at the AC Delco Las Vegas Nationals, Nellis Air Force Base right nearby. So you not only do you get the race, you get an air show. Time now for Funny Car. Tony Pedregon and Whit Bazemore are both striving for their first Funny Car Championship. Pedregon is in the driver's seat, but if he slips up today, Bazemore is ready to strike. If Bazemore slips up, Tony can clinch the title. The pressure is mounting for both these drivers as they try to outdo each other today. And take a look in the last nine races. It has not been pretty for either one of these guys. Look at the round record. 9-8 for Tony, 11-7 for Whit Bazemore. And five first-round losses for Tony. And that one DNQ. Take a look at the ladder quickly. Arrow indicates who has the lane choice. There's Tony on the left side. Scotty Cannon, Gary Selzy, Team Schumacher also over there. Could help Whit, maybe. And there is Whit over on the right side. As we get ready, we're on board with Rick Stewart and Hat Cam. Two guys that have been spectacular lately, Dean Scusa and Tim Wilkerson. I mean, these guys, only John Forrest has won more rounds since Denver than these two.
Yeah, definitely the two best independent single car teams out there. Tim Wilkerson winning the U.S. Nationals in Maple Grove. Dean Scusa have been running very consistent. Both cars are doing very well.
He saw the problems for Scusa about half track and a 490 at 314 miles an hour sends Tim Wilkerson on to second round. Let's check in with Dave Reif.
Down staging lanes with Don Schumacher, and we're just checking over the funny car ladder, Don. You got some teammates in some real good positions today if all the stars are in alignment.
Yeah, we really need Gary to take out John Force in the first round. We want Gary to win first round, of course. We need Whit to win first round, Scotty to go on, and then Scotty could possibly meet Tony Pedregon in the second round. We need him to take Tony out. So we got a lot of good things looking forward to. We just need to go out here and win a race.
As the engines come to life, let's take a look at Funny Car.
Well, it's basically the same engine as the top fuel counterparts. 500 cubic inches, the maximum allowed. And to do that, they get the stroke at 4.5 inches. That's the amount that the piston travels inside each cylinder. The bore size is 4.187. Same compression, 6.5, 7.5 to 1 to fill that cylinder full of fuel to make over 7,000 horsepower to propel these cars well over 320 miles per hour.
We come back to the action here at the strip at Las Vegas Motor Speedway. The burnout complete for Phil Burkhardt over in that left lane in the blue CSK car. Of course, he went to the runner-up spot at the Fall Chicago race since coming on board, replacing Johnny Gray. This team has been going rounds. Bob Bodie over in the right lane. And Bob hates probably to be reminded of this, but he's the one half of the most famous double DQ ever here at Las Vegas when both he and John Force left before the tree was activated, and both were disqualified. Let's go to the far end. Check in again with Bill.
Tim Wilkerson on the tail end of his first career multi-win season, and you'd like to salt away one or two more before it's all over.
Yeah, you know, the points are getting close here at the end of the year. We want to stay in the top 10, top 6 or 7 if we can. For Levi Ranch out, Matt Tools, all the folks that support our car. I mean, we need to keep going around. So, hey, we're a John Force fan now. He needs to take out Selzy for me next round. Thanks.
This guy races hard. He gets your teeth into you. He ain't letting go.
Isn't it interesting, the different perspectives? You talk to Don Schumacher, it's exactly the opposite.
Boy, these guys are selfish, aren't they?
Yeah, and you'd be just the same if you were out there.
You're darn right.
All right, let's get ready for this one as these two come to the line. Winner here will go up against either Whit Bazemore or Tommy Johnson Jr. looking like Bodie was in deep. And then he strikes the highs, 496 and 302. And Phil Burkhardt is going to move in to the second round. So stay with us. A lot more funny car action coming your way, including the two Titans in the championship battle.
The strip at Las Vegas, Nevada, where action in the NHRA continues. Tony Schumacher just rolled into his pits a minute and a half ago. Now he's facing Darrell Russell in round two of eliminations. Darrell's been in the pits for 38 minutes. Their turnaround almost complete. This team has a lot of work ahead of it, as all the teams do during the 75-minute turnaround time. It's, you can see these guys are a well-oiled U.S. Army machine, Marty.
And Parker, that's the double-edged sword that being the number one qualifier and choosing that number eight pair presents.
Yeah, I mean, being the last pair, you get to watch all the other cars and you can make adjustments, but then you have less time. But remember, the 75-minute rule starts after that last car goes down the track.
Back out on the track, it's time for our next pair as we get ready for funny car action with Gary Denchum and Keith Jackson. Denchum, winner here back in 2001 in the spring race. Of course, Jackson, a part-time racer since 1991, has only one round win in his career. But that was an upset of Tony Pedregon back at round one at Sonoma. So it has happened before for this man. He might just be able to put another John Force car on the trailer.
Yeah, you never know in drag racing, Marty. But I'll tell you what, Jimmy Brock, Gary Denchum, that car is very, very impressive. I mean, they are the third John Force car, so I think they don't get a lot of the credit they deserve. They make a ton of horsepower. The car runs very, very fast. Problem is, obviously, when you make that much horsepower, you tend to smoke the tires. They run into that problem every now and then. If this car goes down the racetrack, it is very, very tough to beat. Keith Jackson, he's going to go up there and just basically run his own game. He's got Glenn Michaels on board, just making that car go down the racetrack. If he can just do that, and basically Gary Denchum makes mistakes, spins the tires, he can be in the next round, just like we saw back in Sonoma when he took out Tony Pedregon in the first round.
That was a great shot of the crowd here at the Strip at Las Vegas. I think it's the biggest crowd we've seen here on race day ever. Hurts the car in the process, but Keith Jackson has now beaten two-thirds of the John Force camp. And I don't know if the Las Vegas oddsmakers would have put any odds on that happening.
Man, those guys are going to hate coming against Keith Jackson, but it looked just like something broke in Gary Denchum's car. Susie hit the throttle.
So our next matchup, there it is, Tony Pedregon and Terry Haddock. More on that one when we come back. Don't forget, when we wrap it up here at 7 o'clock Eastern Time, switch immediately over to ESPN2. Two more hours of final eliminations here at the AC Delco Las Vegas Nationals. For more, just log on to ESPN.com. Let's go to Bill and talk to a thrilled Keith Jackson.
Hey, the last time I talked to you when you got your first round win, it was against the John Force car, and you just did it again. You're not very popular over there.
No, I don't imagine they like me too much right now, but... That's part of racing. Sunday morning, it doesn't matter what happens. We ran good yesterday. That was kind of unexpected for us. But hey, if Force stays in, maybe we'll get a race him today, huh?
Keith Jackson's a great story. A match racer for a long time, just to earn enough money to stay out there. Horribly burned last year in a match race, but back in a race car, and look what he did today.
And you saw the graphic, 24th in points, just punched out number four in points. And now get ready, because here is Tony Pedregon. What's really significant, Terry Haddock, if you remember back to Maple Grove, Terry took out John Force in round number one. He has just seen Keith Jackson do it, and he's hoping lightning can strike twice. Debrief.
And Marty, I shadowed this team, Tony Pedregon's team, as they came around the tower into the water box, and I watched John Medlin dig into the clutch timer box as many as three different times. I asked him, what did you change? And he said to me, I didn't change anything. I said, so are you second-guessing yourself or what? He says, well, we just want to make sure everything is right for this mid-480 path. That's what he's targeting. But my God, sounds like to me that the team's feeling a little bit of pressure right now.
Well, obviously they're feeling a lot of pressure, but that's the key. I mean, they're just trying to make sure there's no mistakes, and that's the same thing Tony's trying to do. He wants to make sure he doesn't make any mistakes. Because even though they got Terry Haddock covered by 0.2 seconds, obviously in drag racing, anything can happen, as we saw with Gary Denchum. So they're just double-checking, triple-checking to make sure everything works right, and if it does, it goes down the racetrack, they should be in the next round.
number 15 qualifier has advanced. The number 16 qualifier could put the points leader on the trailer if he can do it right here. Pedregon and Medlin say no way. 488 at 313. Haddock gave it a good run, 4.97 seconds, but just not enough. Good move here by Medlin.
Yeah, John Medlin called it pretty close. Said he's going to try to run a mid-480. Comes up with a 488. This was a nice pass through here. This is a point where they were getting in trouble. A lot of teams spinning out in the middle right over that bump, but that thing stayed stuck pretty good. Starts mixing the cylinders up a little bit before the finish line, but they had the momentum and got into the next round.
Let's check in with Parker.
Well, Marty, crew chief Wayne Dupuy thinks he's got Joe Amato's top fuel dragster figured out. Maybe when we last checked in, you could see Tony Schumacher's crew maximum RPMs. The Darrell Russell crew, well, they're back to cruise RPMs because they're just about finished turning this car around. They're getting ready to start it here in just a few minutes. And as you mentioned, for Tony Schumacher's guys, going last in first round of eliminations puts a lot of pressure on those guys going into the second round of eliminations.
And out on the starting line now, a couple of champions. There is the 12-time Funny Car champion, John Force, in the other lane, three-time Top Fuel champion Gary Selke. And this could be the end of an era. Think about this, folks. As you look at this, if John Force loses today in this round or in any round, there will be a new Funny Car champion for the first time in a decade. And that is astounding. Right now, let's go to the far end to the man who is the heir apparent. He's with Bill.
Every round is clutch. There are no easy ones, no gimmies. Terry Haddock was giving you a pretty good one there, but you survived.
I love this country, but not a good time to see the red, white, and blue. But I've been down this road before with this same team, with this group of guys. Ford, thank goodness they make the horsepower that they do. And Medlin and Dickey, MBNA, AAA Southern California. Just gotta conduct work as usual, the way we do, and I don't want to deviate from that. I have to do my job, and I got all the faith in the world in these guys and what they can pull off.
You might want to hang out and just watch the rest of this round.
Yeah. There you see the numbers for Gary Selke, and you saw earlier for John Force. And look at this, Chubby Checker. Chubby, let's do the twist. He's just trying to keep his ears from blowing off.
He's twisting away from the starting line, what he's doing, because it's going to get loud here in a couple seconds.
He's right down on the island between both cars. Here we go. From the championship chase by Gary Selke, 487 to 492, and another page of history in NHRA drag racing history has just been turned.
Hey, Marty, do you think both these guys were ready for this race? An 0.26 reaction time for Gary Selke, and he was behind John Force by 200ths of a second, 0.005 for John, but he didn't have the horsepower. That Mike Knepp horsepower right there in the middle, you're going to see that thing come on strong. That's a problem they had all weekend. They couldn't get run through the middle and on the top end, but we know that thing's the fastest car in the business. 321 miles per hour, he needed it to drive around John Force.
And there is the reaction from Chubby Checker as he's grabbing a hold of Dave Reeves saying, Hart, my golly, let's go to Dave.
From Kiss, we now move to the beginnings of rock and roll down with Chubby Checker. Look like you came up with a new dance step.
I mean, I sure did. I mean, it's fabulous, it really was.
Give me your description again, because you were being very vocal about it.
Every nerve in my body just, I was scared. I said, this is what it is all about. I never heard such in my life.
Best description yet, and that was from behind the toolbox. We got to get him in front of it, Bill.
Well, down here with Tony Pedregon, you know now that the boss can't tackle you from behind, Tony.
Well, we're all pulling for each other, and we all qualified well. Had three Mustangs in the top four, but at this point, I think he's supporting us, and I know what he wants to see. He wants to see us put this to rest, and that's what we're really trying to do. So he's always been great at being able to make that transition from driver to team owner, and he keeps us motivated, and that's real important, especially at this point.
The John Force car goes to the championship. John Force will not be the one in it.
And there is the only guy that could stand in the way of that championship. He's up next. the strip at Las Vegas Motor Speedway, and everyone is on the edge of their seat as we've got Tommy Johnson and Whit Bazemore. But first, let's salute the former champ, Bill.
John Force, you know, you had a 005 light, man. You were ramped up and you were ready, and you just got tweaked at the end.
Trying to get that number two spot away from Bazemore. Tony took on another round, and you get up against Gary Sousa. You get up on the tire, and you push it as deep as you can do it, and you're wired up. You're on Krispy Kreme and Powerade. What do you want me to tell you? But he's a good kid. He's a good kid. So let's try to lock up this championship today. That's what we want to do most. And I'm proud of Tony Pettigon. May have to give up my deal. I'm going to have to give up my deal. But I'll still be the champ, and there will be a new one crowned here, hopefully, this weekend.
It is somewhat ironic that a three-time Top Fuel champion ends the reign of a 12-time funny car champion.
And there's Gary Selzy coming over. And, you know, we have drilled Gary when he's been late on the tree, but an 026 light. And he said, you know, a lot of the time that's because I shallow stage, and that's a big explanation. But right now, Whit Bazemore has to win this matchup with Tommy Johnson Jr. TJ was first off the line with a 002 light. He had six 100s in the bank, but smokes the tires. A 490 at 307, and Whit Bazemore still breathing.
Man, that was a lot. I was lucky for Whit Bazemore. Like you said, 600ths of a second. TJ, I think, probably took a little bit of a shot at the tree. But I'll tell you what, Whit Bazemore, Lee Beard, they did what they had to do. They got this car down the racetrack. Wasn't a big number, but he ran a 490. He was in a little bit deep, but not too bad. Took a little bit of lap time off it, but that's still a very good run. Cylinder goes out right before the finish line. They're in the next round, though. Let's check in with Parker.
Well, Tony Pettigon just arrived in the pits. His car's bodywork came off. The first order of business with the funny car team, crew chief John Medlin. First thing he did, download the computer data from that round one victory. And you can see, with a much shorter wheelbase in the Top Fuel car, these guys are crammed together a little tighter, but yet they're just as efficient, just as fast as their dragster brethren.
And you don't think those guys are nervous also? They don't want to make a mistake because, believe it or not, they are very much aware that their mistake could cost their man a chance at the championship today. That work continues, the action continues back out on the track as funny car action resumes with Ron Capps and Frank Pettigon. Let's go to the far end of Bill.
First talk to Gary Selzy, who puts the finishing touches on John Force's string of championships.
You know what, I hit the gas in the Oakley Dodge, that thing left really good. The next thing you know, there's a Mustang out that left window. And then when that clutch locked up, she went 1-to-1 and that Hemi kicked in, baby, it was all over but to the crying. And
it's all Hemi, baby.
I haven't helped him all year long, and I finally got Force out of the way, and it's a beautiful thing, believe me.
Well, you've kept saying you don't give up, you haven't given up.
No, you know, it's a tough day, a tough couple races left for Matco Tools Dodge team, but, you know, until it's mathematically over, we're going to fight for the Power 8 championship. It's the only reason we're here, and, you know, we want to thank the guys at Power 8 for the great championship and all they do, but, you know, Tony, they're a great team, and they're still alive, too, so we've got our work cut out, but as long as we got my buddy Selzo over there taking out the whole competition, it makes it a lot easier. It's good.
What a great stretch run we're watching.
The drama continues in funny car. Right now, Ron Capps, Frank Pettigon, two guys that have been struggling mightily the last few races. And a good close race. And a 492 gives Frank Pettigon the win at 307 miles an hour. The margin of victory, just 18/100ths of a second. Stay with us. More when we come back. The work continues at Tony Pettigon's pit. Back here at the strip at Las Vegas Motor Speedway at the AC Delco Las Vegas Nationals, you're looking at Del Worsham, and he has a chance, well, to move in on Gary Densham for fourth place in the championship hunt. Scotty Cannon, of course, trying to advance to help teammate Whit Bazemore, because the winner of this one gets Tony Pettigon in the next round.
Yeah, Scotty Cam would definitely like to get this win, but I'll tell you, Dale Worsham's awfully tough. I mean, he struggled a little bit qualifying the first three runs, didn't make a good pass, but then came back and made a decent pass on that last one. And we've seen Dale Worsham do that a number of times, struggling qualifying. Once he gets a pretty good baseline, get a handle on it, he goes off and he can win the race. You can never count Dale Worsham out. Scotty Cannon, he's running the good numbers, but definitely not the consistency that he needs if he wants to win the entire race. But that doesn't mean he can't lay down a number right now and be able to take out Dale Worsham.
Remember, if you weren't with us yesterday, Scotty announced he is going to return to Pro Mod with Oakley sponsorship next year. Certainly, he would like to go out with a money car win before the season is over. Smoke. He was out on Dell, and then you see the blower belt go as well, and Dell takes the win light 492 at 315 miles an hour. So it'll be Dell Worsham matching up with Tony Pedregon, and Tony will have lane choice. Gary Selzy with the choice over Tim Wilkerson, Frank Pedregon, and Whit Bazemore have the lane choice over on the opposite side. Let's go to Parker.
Marty, there are rumors that Tony Pedregon might be leaving John Force Racing at the end of the season to join brother Cruz in a two-car funny car team. And Tony, on the verge of winning your first NHRA championship, why would a driver leave this team?
Well, it was, you know, nothing's done, nothing's been signed. It was simply a consideration. And this is something that started years and years ago that Cruz and I, we didn't have this long-term plan, but it was something I was simply looking at. And of course, with all the rumors and, you know, all the gossip that goes around in this business, it's just kind of, it's blown up a little bit more than it actually is. So at this point, the championship is what we have our sights set on. And maybe at the end of the year, we'll probably make a determination as to what the future holds for me.
And Dave, I think we know him better than that, don't we?
I think so. No rumors going on in Pro Stock Bike when it comes to the championship. You are looking at the man who pretty much controls his own destiny, Gino Scala. We were just talking some first-round jitters that are, well, you said normal, but come on.
Yeah, really, you know, I look at this, I take this seriously. This is a professional sport, and this is my job, you know? So I have to stay focused. If I stay focused, I'm going to do well. I know everybody's talking about if I go two rounds today, I could clinch the championship. And that's all, that's in the back of my mind now because a million of you guys and all the fans keep asking me, sign it number one. I says, no, I cannot sign number one until I am number one because anything can happen.
But you had a nice distraction away from the racetrack last night.
Oh, yes. One of my sponsors, Hockams, Kurt Leventon and Evelina. They got married last night, and I was their best man, and my wife was maid of honor. So it was pretty cool. I got to experience like a Elvis Presley Las Vegas wedding, you know? That is pretty neat.
Viva Las Vegas.
Hey, you got married in Las Vegas, didn't you?
Yeah, 21 years ago, Marty.
That wasn't the car that took you to their church, was it?
No, I was faster than that.
Stay with us, the Wheel Stander here on Friday night. Here at the AC Delco Las Vegas Nationals at the Strip at Las Vegas Motor Speedway. And Sanyo is proud to bring us our aerial pictures from the Sanyo Lightship. Chief Pilot Steve Tomlin and cameraman Mike Wolf are in the blimp working with us today. Guys, glad to have you with us. Hey, want to remind you about Monday Night Countdown, 7:30 on ESPN. Stuart Scott, Michael Irvin, Ron Jaworski, Tom Jackson, they've got it all for you. Then you switch over to ABC because it's Miami led by Ricky Williams. They're traveling to San Diego to take on LaDainian Tomlinson and the Chargers. Monday Night Football, 9 o'clock Eastern on ABC TV. Time now for today's Suzuki Track Fact. Track Fact brought to you by Suzuki, maker of innovative motorcycles and all-terrain vehicles.
One of the most amazing aspects of the Pro Stock category is that the engines produce well over 1,000 horsepower utilizing carburetors, not modern-day electronically controlled fuel injection. The tuners of these motors have to analyze the spark plugs to get the fuel-air mixture just right, Mike.
Parker, as far back as I can remember, tuners have used the same device to do that. What it is a basic magnifying glass with a light that allows them to see the end of the spark plug. Usually what they'll do is they'll look at the end of the electrode and the insulator to determine the amount of heat on the spark plug and make adjustments accordingly. Usually in the case of Pro Stock, they'll adjust the jets or the timing to try to get that proper combustion.
Pro Stock driver Jim Yates has taken the art of analyzing spark plugs up a notch, moving from a magnifying glass to a microscope. Now, this device you would typically find inside an optometrist's office. Your chin would rest here, forehead here, and the optometrist would look deep into your eyes. Well, now, Jim Yates is looking deep into the electrodes and insulators of spark plugs. Mike?
Well, and Parker, in a category where winning and losing oftentimes is determined by thousandths of a second, you're always trying to get that advantage, and Jim Yates is hoping that this will give him the advantage to get him in the winner's circle on Sunday.
And thanks, guys. When we come back to Las Vegas, first round of Pro Stock action. Oh, it's going to be good. Stay with us. Back here at the AC Delco Las Vegas Nationals. And as we show you from the Sanyo Lightship, there is the strip at Las Vegas Motor Speedway. And right over there is the oval, 18,000 more seats going up. You can see all the work and background. But, you know, that's where Winston Cup and Busch Series car do battle. And if you think those stock cars are fast, well, let's go toe-to-toe with the pro stock cars of the NHRA.
My name is Kurt Johnson.
My name is Ron Hornaday.
I'm a race car driver. 10-year veteran.
24-year veteran. I race door-to-door at 190 miles per hour.
200 plus.
0 to 80 in 6 seconds.
In 6 seconds, I'm at 206.
500 miles in an afternoon?
I do it in 1,320 feet.
My car corners on a dime.
Mine doesn't have to.
This I gotta see.
Pure speed, intensity.
All guts. NHRA drag racing.
Drag racing.
Next.
And our thanks to Ron Hornaday, a former Truck Series champion, as we get ready for the factory hot rods. And let's show you the matchups in round number one. Guess who's on point? Greg Anderson. Surprise, surprise. There you see the arrow indicates who has the lane choice over on the right side. Well, Jason Lyne, his teammate, going for Rookie of the Year next year in the number two position. First matchup is going to be Barry Grant and Ron Krischer. And Barry, boy, he's been struggling just to make the fields lately. Got in on the number nine spot on his last run. Ron Krischer in the number eight position.
You know, Ron Krischer, we haven't seen much of him since his win in St. Louis either, even though he's been getting in the show every now and then. He's definitely been struggling. It's not the Ron Krischer of old, but he seems to be trying to turn this thing around, as is Barry Grant getting in the show. Both cars ran pretty good to make the field today.
Seven of the 16 drivers in the field today have never won a pro stock car race. Two of the 16 have never won a round of competition, and Warren Johnson is not qualified. Does that show you how wild and woolly qualifying was in pro stock this weekend? From Rick Stewart's hat cam, we're going to watch the launch. Oh, and Barry Grant fades quickly. Ron Krischer goes 691 at 199 miles an hour, so he almost matches his qualifying effort and takes the win light here in the opening of our Pro Stock session. Let's take a look at Pro Stock specs.
Well, Pro Stock, they have the same cubic inch allowment, 500 cubic inches, but they do it a little bit differently. A shorter stroke, 3.65 on the stroke, and the bore's a little bit bigger to get that 500 cubic inches, 4.650 on the bore. The compression, obviously higher. They don't run the nitromethane gasoline, 15 to 16 to 1 on the compression ratio.
Come back to the starting line. It'll be Larry Morgan and Jim Yates. And the big news involving Jim Yates, as you see there, he is going to be searching for a new major sponsor. Splitfire is leaving at the end of the season. Some other news we can tell you, Scott Jeffrion is going to have a teammate next year. Hurley Blakeney, the car owner, and Bob Pinella, the engine builder, is going to share the second car. Summit has re-signed with Mark Powell. Young Life is back with Mike Edwards. And Larry Morgan, well, we think there may be some changes in the Dodge camp, although we don't know exactly how it's all going to shake out yet.
Larry Morgan and the Mopar, they seem to not be able to run quite as well in the altitude. He's been qualifying in the top half, but here he's only a number 10 spot, made a good run, but not what we've been seeing in the last few races. And Bob Glidden's really been getting a handle on this race car. He's been getting that thing down the racetrack, but they just have a little bit of trouble in the altitude.
Sanyo Lightship. Bit of a staging duel. Now they finally move in. Almost dead even. Oh, so close at the stripe. Larry Moore. Morgan takes the win, 690 to a 691. The margin of victory is 9/1000th of a second. That's what it looks like.
Boy, just a great side-by-side track race there.
Take a look at the incrementals. Arrow indicates who was leading at which stage of the run.
Yeah, like you said, Marty, basically they left dead even, and then at 60 feet, Larry Morgan had a great launch there, but then Jim Yates goes by at the half track, and then on the other end, Larry Morgan was able to come by. What a great drag race.
And already the next pair of factory hot rods on the line and completing the burnouts. It'll be Troy Coughlin in the left lane and Taylor Laster over
the wall,
in the right.
Troy. There you go, straighten it out.
That's Troy's radio as the crew backs him up.
I'm back.
This is his 200th career pro stock event. Taylor Laster, he's not won a round since Brainerd. There's Troy's numbers so far this weekend at 690, what came on the Friday night session.
Yeah, as my understanding, they broke the engine on that 690 run and didn't quite have the performance on Saturday after that. Taylor Laster, he's made some decent runs in qualifying. This should be a good matchup.
Troy, of course, went to the finals at the Maple Grove, fouled out in that final against Warren Johnson.
I mean, Troy's program definitely has seemed to come around the last probably five or six races or so. They definitely seem to be making the horsepower and getting it down the racetrack much more consistently.
Cars pre-staged. Troy shuts it off. Taylor Laster goes seven flat at 198. Not a very stout run, but it's good enough to take this first round win.
A little bit of a surprise there, Marty. It sounded like Troy's car just did. There sounded like something was wrong. You could hear when he's trying to hit the gears. I don't know if they had a transmission problem or what, but fortunately for Taylor Laster, he was able to at least get the win on seven flat. Let's take another look at there. You see the tire shake right there. It gets a little bit sideways. But I'm not sure if it just got loose and he shut off because it didn't sound right to me, but we'll have to check maybe a little bit later, see what happens. Taylor Laster on the other hand, look at him. He moved over to the right pretty good when he spun the tire, grabbed the gear, lost a lot of ET. That's why he slowed down, only ran a seven flat.
Well, now brother Jeg is in the very same lane.
That's great.
You can hear him getting the instructions on the backup procedure. He'll be up against Nick Fratt. Of course, Jeg won the championship, clinched it here last year, went on to win the race.
A little more to the tree. There you go, 4 feet, you're on.
For Nick Fratt, he's got to be nervous. It's his first NHRA start ever, and here he is up against a guy who's won two Powerade championships.
And the guy is probably considered the best in the business as far as driving and being able to get a car down that racetrack. Jeg Coughlin definitely knows how to trim that tree and hit those shift points and make the perfect runs whenever he needs it.
Oh, Nick, excuse me. This is the hotel calling. It's time to wake up. Look at this. A
6.9 with a 5.223. Good run, Jeg.
I mean, this one was never close. Jeg cuts an 0.25 light, a 1.86 light for Nick Fratt. This one was never in doubt. More when we come back to Las Vegas. Round 22 of 23 in the NHRA Powerade Drag Racing Series, and we're at the AC Delco Las Vegas Nationals at the Strip at Las Vegas Motor Speedway. That is one of the legends of the sport, Bill Grumpy Jenkins, and that is his driver and his motor in that 2003 Cavalier. Dave Conley at the wheel at age 20 has shown an extreme amount of confidence and promise. There's Dave, and Bruce Allen over in the other lane. And one of the more experienced veterans of the sport. Red light for Bruce. Youth wins out in this one. That is his sixth red light of the year for Bruce. A 6.88 at 200 miles an hour. Dave Conley is now quickest of this first round. Let's check in with Dave Reif.
Down in the Whit Bazemore camp, you think, you know, you could probably catch a lot of this turnaround if you see a couple pair of pro stock cars and then run back here in the pits. But no, you miss a whole heck of a lot. This car has already been stripped down. The block has been taken out, and they're in the process of building this car back up from the ground up. You see Lee Beard looking in the clutch timers there. He's got a blocked clutch timer, used a little WD-40 to kind of loosen that up, but no other problems. Very, very happy with his run as the team continues to reassemble this Matco Tools Dodge. The key for this next round, when they go up against Phil Burkhart, Lee Beard says, don't care who it is. Got to go out there and make sure you race the track.
Back out on the track side as we're getting ready for our next pair, Gene Wilson and Kurt Johnson. Of course, he's carrying the Kiss colors as well. There you see Kurt's numbers.
Boy, when you look at Gene Wilson's qualifying numbers, it looks like a fuel car. He only basically made it down the racetrack on one run to get into the show. Not the kind of performance that you're going to need to get around a guy like Kurt Johnson. Kurt, very, very consistent in qualifying. But you know what? This is drag racing. Anything can happen on race day.
Gene Wilson, his future very much in doubt. The one thing he did say is that he'd even consider a Tom Fuel or a funny car ride if it was available to him. So he's still waiting to find out if he's going to be back with this team or moving on to another. Right now, he's got to focus on trying to take out number two in the points. Kurt Johnson, 689, 200 miles an hour. Wilson was first off the line, but a 691, not going to be good enough. Let's take another look from the Sanyo Lightship, and you can see how Kurt will drive around him.
Yeah, this was a good race. Gene Wilson got the whole shot off the starting line, then Kurt Johnson with that GM horsepower just drives around on the other end. 689 to a 691, good race. Watch here, Kurt got a little bit loose early in the run, got a little bit of a bobble, made a nice transition over the bump, one of the smoother runs I've seen over that bump in the left-hand lane. Made a good pass.
Next up, the new Powerade champion, Greg Anderson, collecting his 13th pole position of the year. He'll be in the right lane. Over in the left lane will be Mike Corvo Jr. More on this, but first let's check in with Parker.
Marty, unlike the plethora of crewmen on a fuel team, in pro stock, the numbers are limited. For Ron Krischer, including himself, there are only four crew members working on this car this weekend. They are under the same 75-minute turnaround as the fuel teams. The pace here is a little different. Doors come off first, then the bonnet or the hood, if you will. They look at the clutch. They want to make sure that the valves are adjusted correctly, make carburetor adjustments, maybe some suspension adjustments, but the pace, very, very different. But still, a lot of responsibility for only four crewmen, including the driver.
Yeah, their life only gets hectic if they break a motor, transmission, clutch, something like that.
Yeah, they usually actually service the clutches on every run. They'll pull the transmission, the clutch, and they do make a lot of transmission changes from first round to second round. As the track gets greasier, they'll change that gear ratio to try to compensate for the lesser amount of traction from the first round.
How'd you like to be poor Mike Corvo? This is his second pro stock start. He's up against the new champion, looking for his first ever round win. And Greg's not lost from the pole all season long in first round. Going to lose again. 685. He crushes everybody again. He's low for the round, and that is a new track record, breaking his own record that he set just yesterday. Oh, wow. Unbelievable for Greg Anderson. If you're just tuning in, welcome to the Strip at Las Vegas Motor Speedway. We're at the third running of the AC Delco Las Vegas Nationals. I'm Marty Reid, along with Mike Dunn, Bill Stevens, Dave Reif, Parker Johnstone. And let's take a look at some of the things that you may have missed in first round action. Gary Densham gets beat by Keith Jackson. That's right. Number 24 beats number 4. And then Gary Selzy ends an era as John Force. His reign as champion is over after 10 straight years. Tony Pedregon still battling with Whit Bazemore as those two focus on trying to claim the crown as funny car champion. Right now, we're in first round of pro stock. Mike Edwards, Jason Line coming to the line. No pun intended. Jason going to be going for Rookie of the Year honors next year. For Mike Edwards, well, the wily veteran who is very good on the line, as we've already pointed out, is going to have Young Life back as a full-time sponsor next year.
Yeah, that's great to hear. But I tell you, Marty, it's kind of interesting. All the pro stockers up until Greg Anderson had chosen the left-hand lane. Greg took the right-hand lane and ran low ETO the race. now Jason Lyon, obviously his teammate's going to take the same lane. They obviously see something they like there in that right-hand lane over the left-hand lane. But we saw in the fuel card, both lanes were pretty equal. Pro Stock, I think the jury's still out. I mean, it looks still pretty even. The only thing that mostly concerns him a lot of times is the amount of bumps down track. One lane may be bumpier than the other, and that usually will dictate lane choice for them.
And at the line, Jason Lyon, 689, beats a 691. The margin of victory, 36 ten-thousandth of a second. That's how close it looks at the stripe. Whoa, let's check in with Jason's boss, Greg Anderson.
Can you explain something to me? How can you go 685, low ET for the race, the hottest part of the hottest day we've had all weekend?
We're just gaining on the setup of this car. We kind of missed it all weekend, and we found it last night. It looks like we fine-tuned her a little. That's awesome. Can't say enough about my guys, can I?
No, and I noticed all the other guys in Pro Stock applauding wildly. They're very happy for you.
All right, as you take a look at the ladder, we should point out Jason Lyon now has two round wins, both of them at the expense of Mike Edwards this year. Lane choice to Anderson and Conley. And also on the other side, Lyon and Kurt Johnson. Let's go to Parker.
Del Orson's crew in the middle of the turnaround thrash for second round of eliminations. They're over the hump. The car now going back together. And Marty, the thing that I find interesting, Del is facing Tony, and Del loves racing John Force Racing. His teammate, Phil Burkhart, well, he's up against Whit Bazemore. We talk about the fate of the championship in the hands of Tony and Whit. It could be in the hands of Del and Phil.
Down here with Jason Lyon, and this is silly season. A lot of rumors going around. All the guys in Pro Stock are saying you're going back to Stock Eliminator next year.
I don't see that happening. I hope not, anyway. Not if I have anything to say about it. I'm pretty happy in Pro Stock and working for Greg and Ken Black.
This car is already thundering. I mean, after only a couple of trips down the racetrack here, this thing is almost as quick as your boss's car.
It is. The car is definitely making me look good. Actually, Rob and Jeff and all the guys at the shop, they do an unbelievable job of getting it ready to go, and it says a lot about their talent, that's for sure.
Stock Eliminator champion in 1993, eligible for Rookie of the Year next year in Pro Stock.
And we've got to take a commercial break. When we come back, as the work continues in Del Worsham's camp, it'll be time for the two-wheel. Yep. The bikes are up next. Just a reminder, when we wrap up here at 7 o'clock Eastern on ESPN, we're going to switch over to ESPN2 for two more hours of final eliminations here from the Strip at Las Vegas Motor Speedway. You are not going to miss a single run in any of the four pro categories. In fact, right now it's time for Pro Stock Bike. Gino Scali can clinch his first ever Pro Stock Bike Championship today. Not bad, considering his first career win came just last season. Gino can put his name in the record book with a strong performance today and fulfill a lifelong dream. And the scenario for Gino, well, it's pretty simple. If he goes one round farther, well, either Sean Gann or Angel Savoie, the championship is his. If they drop out anywhere along the way, they're toast. Reggie Showers, well, it's really a tall order for him. He's got to go three rounds farther than Scali, which basically means Gino's got to lose here, and Reggie's got to win the race. So as you take a look at the matchups here in the opening stanza, it will be Treble, Tonglen, Hines, Showers with the lane choice on the left side, and over on the right side, Savoie, Collis, Scali, and Mike Berry. First matchup is going to be Jay Matthews and Gino Scali. Gino Pitts, I'm surprised. I mean, as the number three qualifier, he got the third choice, and he wanted to be the first pair out.
Yeah, interesting choice, Marty. Maybe he just wants to get it over with. I mean, the bikes, the one thing you got to remember, they're very susceptible to red light. And one of the hardest thing for a driver or rider to do is to go up there and actually tell yourself to kind of slow down. Usually there's some tricks you want to do, maybe not look directly at the light, maybe look off a little bit and try to leave the same way. Because these bikes react very, very quickly when the rider lets out the clutch handle.
Jay Matthews has qualified twice before and both times lost to Angel Savoie in the first round. Now he gets to go up against maybe the next Powerade champion, Gino Scali. Matthews first off the line. But not enough grunt at the far end. 724 to a 740. And Gino Scali has just eliminated Reggie Showers from the championship chase. Let's talk a little bit about Pro Stock bike.
Let's talk about the displacement on these. Now, this is just a two-stroke four-cylinder, not counting the Harley Davidsons. 92 cubic inches, the limit that they're allowed. They do a little bit better, just a little bit over a 2.5-inch stroke. The bore, 3.35. Now, the compression, 21-to-1. That determines how high that piston comes up into the combustion chamber. The higher that amount, they're trying to generate more heat. And that's just a tremendous amount to get these bikes down the racetrack at the speeds of over 190 miles per hour.
Down on the starting line now, it is GT Tonglet on the Harley-Davidson and Karen Stouffer. She'll be over in the left lane. Her second Las Vegas start. She lost round one last year to Angel Savoie. She and GT met up at Columbus in round number one, and she beat him there. GT went red in that matchup. Karen went on to be the runner-up at Columbus. Oh, man. GT tattoos her on the tree. Then run 7:28 at 186 miles an hour to take the win line. And let's talk to Gino Scali. He's with Bill.
Well, a fairly comfortable points lead, but you can't do anything stupid today, and you didn't that time. You get down there clean.
Yeah, I know. It wasn't as clean as I thought because I picked the wrong spot of the track, and I was out of the groove, and I spinning a tire. I heard Jay all the way down there, and I never raced against Jay, so I didn't know what his game plan was. So I ran my own race, and it was a little bit tricky there.
Well, one down, and who knows how many more to go for him.
Thank you, Bill. As back on the starting line, Reggie Showers comes to line. Yesterday, the biggest surprise that we had heard was the fact that Reggie may sit out part or all of next year. A lot of things that he needs to put together. Back home, he'll be up against Sean Connor in this one. He's by far having his greatest season ever in Pro Stock Bike, fourth in the points right now, and only 29 behind Angel Savoie for third. Boy, and Reggie really late on this one. This could cost him dearly. It does. 7:34 hole shot for Sean Connor. He is slower on the ET, but he's first to the stripe because he had a huge advantage, and that does eliminate Reggie from the championship chase. Let's go to Parker.
Marty, I've been watching the crew work down at Dale Worsham's pits. We've only been away from you a few minutes. You can see the cylinder heads are back on. Top of the drivetrain with the rocker arms are being assembled. The head is being torqued as you watch. Then they'll gap the valves, make sure the valve clearance is correct. See at the front of the engine, they're trying to fit a supercharger blower belt there. Little last minute details before the intake manifold, the blower go back on, and then this thing will be fired up and rock and roll.
And back out at the starting line, you're looking at the pole sitter for the second time this year. It was Craig Treble turning in a 7:24 effort to take the top spot. Number 16 qualifier over on the far side there in the left lane, Joe DeSantis.
I tell you, Craig Treble's really looked good this race since getting that bike from Matt Hines. The bike has been down the track every run, making good passes. And if he can keep doing that, he definitely has a shot at winning today.
Treble qualified number one at Sonoma. He went on to the semifinals in that race. He'd like to go a couple of rounds farther there, go right to the final, and then win it. Bit of a staging duel. Now they finally move in. Oh, and DeSantis never moves off the line. And Treble is going to breeze to this win. A 7:26 at 188 miles an hour. So Craig will move into second round, and he will have lane choice over GT Tonglet, who ran a 7:28. So stay with us. We've still got more Pro Stock Bike, and you can actually get some merchandise with ESPN all over it here at the track. Don't forget about Playmakers, 9 o'clock Eastern time, Tuesday on ESPN. One of the teammates is gay. Will the Cougars band together or come apart? Playmakers. It's available in high definition on ESPN HD. Call your cable operator, DirecTV, or the Dish Network today. And all you need to do for more is log on to ESPN.com. You're looking at Angel Savoie, three-time Pro Stock Bike champion. She'll be in the left lane. Josh Helvey, the number 15 qualifier, over in the right lane on the Kawasaki. As these two begin to stage, we should point out Craig Treble. That was his 100th career round victory, so congratulations to him. The win in 7:23, 184 miles an hour on gel, quickest of the session in this first round of eliminations. As boy, old poor Josh Helvey just didn't stand a chance in this one.
Yeah, on gel had the advantage off of the starting line, over 0.02 of a second, and then watch her go down through those bumps. I tell you, that's a wild ride on that bike, but that's a great pass. 7:23 at over 184 miles per hour gets her into the next round.
Let's take another look at Angel going through those bumps.
Yeah, the track's very bumpy here. They have a tunnel that goes underneath the track, and it kind of definitely transitions not real well there. You're going to see a lot of times they'll lift the front wheel off as they hit those bumps. You want to have the bike set before you hit them, and she looks like she's pretty straight right there. You see the bumps right there, and that's the key, having that bike set straight and straight up in the seat when you hit that thing. Otherwise, this can be a wild ride.
Back at the starting line, engines fired already for Sean Gann, and that man right there, Fred Collis. Collis will be over in the left lane. For Sean, well, he won his first race here back in 2001. And we were talking about weddings in Las Vegas. Fred's crew chief, Ken Johnson, is getting married to fiancée Kathy here tomorrow in Las Vegas. We wish him well. Uh-oh. Fred late on the light by a bunch, and it's going to cost him dearly. As you saw from the Chandler light chip, another hole shot for Collis. That is his second reaction time loss of the year. It goes with 8 fouls. It's been either feast or famine for him. Let's check in at the far end with Bill.
With Angel Savoie, who mathematically is still in this championship fight, but I talked to you earlier today. You just want to remember what it's like to win a race.
I just said I love winning first round. This year has definitely taught me to appreciate every single round win. And I have to give thumbs up to Gino Scali and his crew. They're doing an awesome job. I'm coming to terms with, you know, hopefully just having the number 2 on my bike. But you know what? I got to give this one to the soldiers overseas, and especially to the ones at Walter Reed Hospital. We're going to be going there soon to visit with some of you guys. I couldn't do this if it weren't for them.
Angel's last win in Joliet in May, final round against her good friend Reggie Showers.
Well, and she matches up next round against Sean Gann. So for one of those two, championship will be over at the end of second round. Michael Phillips now, and Mike Berry. Phillips, closest to you in the right lane. Light to Mike Berry. He was the runner-up, of course, back at Denver. He puts Michael Phillips, who was the surprise winner at Maple Grove, on the trailer. 7:26 to a 7:33. And speaking of Sean Gann, let's go back to Bill.
And let's talk to Sean Gann about the fact, sort of like Angel, it's been a while since you won a race, but you're still alive for the championship, so you can accomplish a couple of things today.
Well, you know, that's what everybody set out to do, is win the championship, but you know, if it don't happen for us, we're going to be happy second. And Mack Tools and Airtech and Technico Companies is coming along with me for next year. Man, I'm telling you, next year is going to be a blast.
Hey, if he wins the championship this year, that's one party I want to go to.
Yeah, you do.
Back at the starting line, it's Antron Brown and Andrew Hines. You're looking at Antron. And as these two come together, Andrew fouled out to Antron the only time they have met, and that was back at Indy at the U.S. Nationals. That was round number 2.
Antron struggled in qualifying, did not get into the show until the final qualifying session, had to just kind of basically get it down the racetrack and get in the show.
Oh, 2 good lights, both riders. And Andrew Hines hands Antron his 3rd straight first round loss, a 7:27 at 182 to Antron 7:35 at only 180 miles an hour. And that will be good enough for Hines to have lane choice over Sean Connor. Let's check in again with Bill.
And Mike Berry, how about that? Beats the rider that won in Maple Grove, and you're looking for your first national event win.
Yeah, we've been working really hard trying to, you know, speed it up and be a little more consistent, trying not to make so many changes. You know, we keep killing ourselves with changing motors and everything after one round of qualifying, and we changed our strategy a little bit this weekend, and it looks like it's helping.
Well, he's come so close before a couple of times, almost won the Can-Am Clash in Indy, and of course went to his first career final in Denver this year.
And as we take a look at the matchups in round number two, it's really starting to shake out here. Treble and Hines on the left side have the lane choice, but where it really gets interesting is over on the right side. We talked about it. Savoie and Gann, one of those guys is going to be eliminated next round, and there's Gino waiting potentially in the semifinals. Let's go back to Bill.
But Andrew Hines, who wins today for Antron Brown, and hey, these Harleys, they're getting there.
Yeah, they're coming around real fast. Man, we've had a really consistent bike this weekend. I rolled out of the beams the first round of qualifying, but we went back to the computer and found out it was about a 28 or 29 pass. So basically, we're the only bike out here in the 20s this weekend, every pass, and we're just going to go four rounds today on Sunday and bring home a win for Harley.
Hey, I think we might see your brother Matt out here again soon?
Maybe. Treble's out here testing his bike, and who knows, maybe Matt might jump on it sooner or later.
More silly season stuff.
Matt still holds the national speed record. Now, let's go back to Saturday, just in case you weren't with us. This was a frightening moment for us all as Cruz Pedregon in the right lane just exploded at the lights and then hit the wall hard. Watch this contact. He got his bell rung.
Boy, he definitely did. One of those things when the thing exploded, lifted the back of the car up, drove that right wheel in into the ground, and then shoved the car towards the left into the wall. So you can see here, he had two cylinders out. One was out early, and then the other one went out. Shortly after that, then the thing erupts into a ball of flames. The back of the car, like we saw Dell, goes up in the air. But this time when it came down harder on the right-hand side and drove it into the wall.
And I think Cruz has made it back to the track again today. Let's check in with Parker.
Yes, he has, Marty. And my friend, it's good to see you standing here in your pits. First of all, how are you?
I'm okay. I'm a little banged up, but got a little fire on my face. And I get hit my head pretty good. I'm going to work on trying to make the roll bars a little safer and trying to get it to where it don't hit as hard.
Now, what do you remember about yesterday? I mean, obviously the launch, but at some point, because I've been in this situation before, things get a little dark at some point.
Well, yeah, I remember going down the track. I didn't remember right after the run. I remember going down the racetrack thinking, God, this thing feels pretty good. I know I was racing Densham, and about the finish line when I was reaching to pull a parachute and do everything, I remember the boom and the fire, and just like a dream from that point on, I was kind of a little dazed, but I was trying to drive it, last I remember, but get hit in the noggin pretty hard there. You it wasn't a real good feeling, but, it was a situation where the car dropped a cylinder, and then it dropped another cylinder, and because we weren't in the field, I was legging it, man. I was letting her hang out, and that's the consequence. It wound up breaking a valve, which caused the explosion, dropped a number 8 valve, but, there's a lot of power here, and these things happen, though. I've been around this sport a lot of years, and I've been in some pretty good ones, and not as bad as that. But, these things happen, Parker, and we found out what happened. Our fuel system added fuel in it too quick. It's not like we don't know what happened. We know what happened, I can't wait for Pomona. I'm a little beat up, I'm not going to lie, but for Advance Auto Parts and everybody, we want to finish off strong, get in the top 10, and we still have that win we're waiting for, so hopefully at Pomona we can get it.
Now, you've been fielding a lot of questions the last few weeks about the two-car future of this team. I just spoke to your brother, Tony, and he said, and you have told us, that there will be an announcement at SEMA. Can you give us any more insight? Because Tony said you and he have been planning a two-car team for a long time.
Well, actually, we've been planning a three-car team with my brother, Frankie. So, it's our dream to get together one day, someday, and get all the brothers together, myself and Tony and Frankie. But, I would like to talk and jump up and down because it's a very, very exciting opportunity for us. But we're going to keep a lid on it till Tuesday at the SEMA show. So all of you that go to the SEMA show, come check us out in the NHRA Powerade booth. But it's an exciting time for us. Like I said, these things happen. And so you have to put things in perspective. We could have easily not dropped a cylinder on that run and run a 485, and we'd be having a different conversation right now. But the fact is, we did drop a cylinder. When these engines lose a cylinder, all heck breaks loose inside and stuff does, it comes apart. And so we're going to make some extra safety precautions to keep that from happening. But hey, we're still excited. We're not going to let this get us down. Been a lot of support from the fans and a lot of people calling me and a lot of fellow drivers. John Force is over here, Worsham and a few guys. So, hey, that means a lot to me. And we're just going to move on.
Cars can be replaced, but not drivers, at least according to the team owners. But when you're the team owner and the driver, it's good to be in one piece back at the track, Dave.
Of course, unless you're the team owner with a son, like Kenny Bernstein is, ready to close down what? Forever at another run to remember? Hard to believe it's winding down again.
Well, we weren't supposed to be here to begin with, and obviously we had to jump in there, and you're right, it's closing down, a couple more to go, and that's it. And we're good. Brandon's doing great. He's back in almost full 100% recovery now, another month, and we'll get ready for next year with him in the car and keep right on going.
A year ago, this was kind of a tough pill to swallow. It's a little bit easier the second time around?
Well, yeah, possibly so, because I know both sides of the fence Now, I know the feeling the first seven or eight races sitting on the sidelines and watching, which I didn't enjoy a whole lot, as everyone knows. But now I know both sides, and I think when we go out there in February at Pomona with the Budweiser team, I'll be ready for it, much more understanding. You got to realize 35 years of doing this, and to just stop cold turkey, I thought I was ready, but I obviously wasn't. So we'll go out there with our Mac guys and Lucas and do a good time, and I'm actually kind of looking forward to a little slowdown, to be honest.
Well, let's talk about Vegas a little bit. This is a place very special to you. You won with your son here a couple years ago.
Yeah, it is special. You've said it right. And my dad was here, and he's here again this weekend. So maybe, and he was in Dallas when we won. So maybe if we win this one, he'll have to go to Pomona too. But it's special here. Great racetrack, great town, great wholesaler here with Budweiser. And we're just going to go out there today and obviously in the sunshine try to hang in there with these guys.
A kinder, gentler team owner next year? We'll find out.
All right, thanks, Dave. Let's remind you that coming up at 7 o'clock Eastern time, we're going to switch over to ESPN2. Two more hours of coverage. You're not going to miss a single car or bike going down the track here at the AC Delco Las Vegas Nationals. We've got to take a commercial break. We'll wrap up our ESPN portion of the broadcast when we return to the city that never sleeps. You by Powerade, AC Delco Automotive Parts, when the right way is the only way, and Suzuki, maker of innovative motorcycles, scooters, and all-terrain vehicles. And as you look at a view of the Paris Casino and Hotel here in Las Vegas, where the odds are always out there for you to gamble on, I think that man right there, I don't think the odds would ever predict there will be another 10-time champion. Let's talk to him, Bill.
Just talking to John Force about the fact that you won't be the 13-time champion this year. But, John, after the start that Tony had, the fact that you didn't win until Denver, this is something you've had time to think about. It really has been a struggle this year.
I laugh every time I hear this because I'm happy to be healthy and my kids are healthy, and I'm happy that I have the funding to race and do what I love to do. And the bottom line, 12-time champ, I'm still the championship team winning, even if my driver chooses to leave. We did it as a team together, and we'll always be proud of that. So nothing changes. So you're not going to – no, I know the guys back in that ESPN room. You want a story. There is no story. We want Tony to win this championship, and we're going to keep fighting here today and try to get there. And sorry, guys, that's all I know for now.
No depression down here, Parker.
Well, Bill, in a surprise announcement yesterday, after 35 years behind the wheel, Arnie Karp announces retirement from driving, but not from the sport.
Absolutely. AK Motorsports will continue. Arnie Karp will continue in the sport. Michael Karp will continue in the sport. My partner Keith will continue. We're hooked up with the Worshams. We're hooked up with T2. We're hooked up with Addison. We're ready to go at it next year.
Marty, the Boston Strangler will return.
And thank you, Parker. This has been a presentation of ESPN, the worldwide leader in sports. For more, log on to ESPN.com. Now, SportsCenter is coming up next on ESPN. But if you want to stay with us, and I hope you do, switch over to ESPN2 now, because we've got two more hours of coverage coming to you from the AC Delco Las Vegas Nationals here at the Strip at Las Vegas Motor Speedway. So for Mike, Bill, Dave, Parker, and our entire ESPN crew, we'll see you over on ESPN2. Make the switch right now. For the AC Delco Las Vegas Nationals, glad you're with us. The fans are lining the fences. It's been our largest crowd ever in Las Vegas, and two championships to be decided. Tony Pendragon and Whit Baysmore continue the struggle. Leader in Sports presents exclusive coverage of the $50 million NHRA Powerade Drag Racing Series. Today, from the Strip at Las Vegas Motor Speedway, final eliminations continue here at the third running of the AC Delco Las Vegas Nationals. And if you're just joining us, Marty Reid, along with Mike Dunn, so glad you're with us. Look at some of the fans that have jammed in here. Bill Stevens, Dave Freak, Parker, John Stone are patrolling the pits for us. And we have had a lot of action so far in first round. Let's get you caught up on what happened. First up, Top Fuel. It will be a big surprise in first round. For the first time in 2003, Larry Dixon went down to defeat at the hands of Clay Milliken. Could you tell he was just a little happy about it? And Shirley Muldowney also lost in first round to Corey McLenathan. One more chance to see Shirley. That'll be in 2 weeks at Pomona. Take a look now at the ladder. The matchups in the second round, Tony Schumacher and Doug Pulitta have lane choice on one side of the equation. Over on the other, it's Kenny Bernstein and Scott Pulitta. And let's also get you caught up on first round action in Funny Car. Keith Jackson, the biggest surprise, left side of your screen. He takes down number four in the points, Gary Densham. And then John Force's reign 10 straight years as champ comes to an end. Gary Selzy beats him in first round. Mathematically, John is done. Tony Pedregon did manage to win over Terry Haddock, as did Whit Bazemore over Tommy Johnson Jr. So that championship chase will continue. More on that in a second. Tony Pedregon and Gary Selzy have the lane choice on the left side. Over on the right, it's Frank Pedregon and Whit Bazemore with the lane choice. It still breaks down to this. In Funny Car, Tony Pedregon has to go one more round than Whit Bazemore, and I guess who's feeling the pressure more?
Well, I think they're both feeling the pressure, but maybe a little bit more so for Tony Pedregon. Even though he has a comfortable lead, one of the things you don't want to do is go out there and lose the race. I mean, basically, you want to not get complacent. You want to go out there and do what he's been doing all year long. Hit, get your lights, drive the race car, stay focused. If you can do that, you're going to be okay. Whit Bazemore, on the other hand, he's really got nothing to lose. He's just, his main focus is to go out there and win the race.
And our championship in Pro Stock Bike is still going on as well. Gino Scali needs to go one more round than Angel Savoie or Sean Gann. Stay with us. We come back. Top Fuel. We return to the AC Delco Las Vegas Nationals. To the third running of the AC Delco Las Vegas Nationals, brought to you by Powerade. AC Delco Automotive Parts, when the right way is the only way. And Subway, good so you don't always have to be. Subway, eat fresh. And you're looking at the MGM Grand. If you slept in each room one night, it would take you 13 and a half years to sleep in every room in the hotel. Hey, Rome is back. The opinionated Jim Rome on ESPN. This week, Steve Francis will be one of his guests from the Houston Rockets. Rome is Burning, presented by Coors Original, Tuesday at 7 Eastern. For more, log on to ESPN.com. Take a look at the matchups now in round number two of Top Fuel. Tony Schumacher, Doug Pulitta have lane choice on the left side. Over on the right, it'll be Kenny Bernstein and Scott Pulitta. And we didn't expect this, but we are very happy to have the champ with us two times. First time you have lost in first round all year long. Your loss, our gain. Thanks for joining.
I know, so I'm thank you. Are you guys excited when I lose? It's like, yeah, then we can get him in the booth.
Absolutely. Oh, yeah. Absolutely.
I appreciate the love.
I have bad news for you. You know that oil down that put you over the limit? You lost 10 points. You think it's going to hurt you in the championship chase?
I hid the check. I ain't going to let him take it back from us.
You were telling us what happened on the run, because I know you've been experimenting with some stuff since you clinched the championship.
Yeah, and it really shouldn't have made any difference on that run. It just went out there, and it spun the tires, and it put a hole out, overboosted the other ones. It burned a piston up, and bang, just like that. I mean, in a matter of seconds.
Well, Larry is going to be with us through this entire second round of Top Fuel and Funny Car, so we're glad to have your expertise, champ. And we get ready now as engines have come to life with Darrell Russell and Tony Schumacher. And, of course, Darrell was a very fortunate winner in first round, had the floor belt come off, spun the tires, but he got to the stripe first. Tony Schumacher, well, he's just been thundering all weekend long. Let's check in now with Dave Reif.
And Marty, with that Top Fuel Championship, Larry Dixon already cinched up. We've been focusing a lot of our energies this weekend on the two classes that have yet to be settled. Of course, Pro Stock Bike and a Funny Car. And you're looking at the man who basically is controlling his own destiny as the rounds start to wind down. Getting easier on you yet?
No, it's not any easier, but the pressure, I got to say, it's been constant, and it's a little different because we know it's all going to go down, or it could go down here. But I think the sanity is that I put the helmet on and close everything off, and I do my thing. I've got all the faith in these guys that they've given me a good race car that'll go down the track. And we've got some tough competition, so we're just going to continue to do our thing and hope for good results.
4.7 seconds, 300 mile an hour, sanity? Never thought I'd say that.
Thanks, Dave. There you see Tony Schumacher in 2003 and his record. For Darrell Russell, there he is. His last semifinal that he advanced to was Memphis. Darrell lost in that one to, I think it was you, Mr.
He doesn't have to worry about me today.
Oh, boy, Tony Schumacher back on stride. 452, 330.72 miles an hour. Let's go to Parker.
Marty, the other protagonist in the Funny Car Championship fight is Whit Bazemore. When I spoke to Whit this morning, he was calm and relaxed. Whit, obviously, you've got your game face on now. You can win these next two races and still lose the championship, but that really doesn't make any difference as far as getting ready for the second round.
No, it doesn't, Parker, because I was talking with Dixon this morning. We had a laugh because, you know, it's pretty cut and dry for us. We have to win both races to even have a chance. And so, you know, the question that I put to him, I said, so what's the difference? I mean, it's the same approach we have every weekend of the year that we race. So to me, it is important, but realistically, it's the same approach that we have for every other round during the season.
Marty?
Thank you, Parker. As we go back to take another look at this run, as Tony Schumacher advances to his sixth semifinal in the last seven races.
Well, we saw Tony drop a cylinder in the first round, but that wasn't the case this run. They went from a 462 to a 452, and that's basically what that other cylinder will do, isn't it, Larry?
Yeah, absolutely, no question. You got eight cylinders with the kind of power that they make. I mean, it's clean drive back to what they were doing in qualifying.
Let's check in with Bill.
Well, you know, Larry Dixon's up in the booth, and he's already clinched the championship, and I'm here with Tony Schumacher, and do you know that if the season began in Indianapolis, you would be leading the points right now by a bunch?
Maybe, but unfortunately for us, it doesn't. We get to look forward to next year. Congratulations to Dixon, the whole Miller Lite team. They went out and won a championship for a second year in a row. That's awesome, you know, and they gave us some great racing all year. We appreciate that. The Army car going to the third round, man, that is huge. Let's wait and see who we got to race, but Alan Johnson has clearly got a handle on this U.S. Army team, and the guys are flawless in all the work they're doing, man. We're loving it.
Darrell Russell, just the latest driver to feel the wrath of this Army rig.
And the next victim will be either Doug Colitta or Corey McLennathan. Right now, we turn our attention back towards the starting line, where Kenny Bernstein, who has had a lot of success here at the Strip at Las Vegas Motor Speedway, will go up against a man who he has never lost to in 12 previous meetings, John Smith.
Well, and it's going to be tough for John because Kenny Bernstein and Tim Richards seem to have a pretty good handle on. Now, even though they saw Tony Schumacher run that 452 in front of him, I think Tim Richards, he knows he's not going to be that aggressive. I think he's just probably going to go up there and try to run maybe the same as he did first round, 459, maybe a little bit quicker, a couple hundreds, and just try to get this round win. What do you think, Larry?
Yeah, no question. I mean, they're going to go down the track, do their own thing, not press anything. And John Smith, if I was those guys, just go down the racetrack, and if they make a mistake, try to capitalize on it. These two guys are fighting for the points positions, too, so there's a lot on the line right now.
That's right, because if John can get past Kenny, he would retake seventh position in the points championship. Kenny is closing in on David Baca, who's in sixth and has already been eliminated. Uh-oh, tire smoke on both cars, and it's Bernstein legging it to the line first in a 490 at 279 miles an hour. So he picks up another 20 points and now will be only 51 behind David Baca for the sixth position. Remember, he started we were a good seven races into the season. Stay with us. We're coming back with more. Here at the AC Delco Las Vegas Nationals, and we're looking down for the best view of today's action. It's inside the Sanyo Lightship, flying overhead with the Eye in the Sky camera, bringing us our beautiful shots of all the racing action and some spectacular shots also of the Las Vegas surrounding area. Thanks, guys. Appreciate you always when you're here. Right now, you're looking at Clay Milliken. First time he ever competed in Top Fuel competition was Reddick back in 1999. The guy he faced, guess what? He's in the other lane. Scott Colitta. Colitta won that matchup. why he came back to beat Scott round two at Reading this year. Let's go to the far end, talk to Kenny Bernstein. Bill.
Oh, be still my beating teenage heart.
Yeah, that was close. That was everything was fine. It was really going good, and it just knocked them loose down there, and I just jumped out of it and got right back in it again, and I could hear him there, and I said, holy cow, I hope so, and I just let him smoke the tires to the finish line.
I told him earlier this year, you can still do this.
Thanks, Bill. As you mentioned, Kenny will go up against the winner of this round right here between Scott and Clay Milliken. Of course, West Coast Chopper sponsorship, Jesse James, Mac Tools on board. There you see Scott's numbers.
You know, Marty, I mean, Scott Collette actually chose the right lane in the first round. Now he's over in the left lane, which is the same thing we saw Tony Schumacher do. Now, Larry, did you notice any difference in the lanes? Obviously, there's a bump down the track. Is it a little worse in the left or the right?
I really think the left lane's got a worse bump in it, but it seems like the left lane's got more grip early, so the crew chiefs are taking the left lane if they have a choice, for the most part, it seems.
And, yes, that was Jesse James who was in that shot, down on the starting line, watching his car. Scott Collette at the wheel. Oh, and a 4:59. Scott goes low for the round, 325 miles an hour. That is a very stout run. Take another look, guys.
Yeah, let's see if we can see that bump here, Larry. I mean, it had a pretty good run. A little bit of tire shake there, but it looked like it went right through. Actually, I saw his hand on the brake. I don't know if, you know, Scott used to drive with the brake when he was a little bit younger, but look at that bump through there. Made a nice job down through there.
Yeah, absolutely. It's clean and dry, and I'm sure Connie's happy with it, and they know they got the setup for Doug's car. It's coming up, in the Parrot.
And let me correct myself. Tony Schumacher's 4:52 obviously is a little bit quicker. Let's check in with Parker. Are you down there, Parker?
Yes, I am, Marty, and you'll never guess what's come to an NHRA event. It's ESPN The Truck. Now, ESPN The Truck goes to 48 sporting and specialty events during the course of a year, and on board ESPN The Truck, you'll find demonstrations of interactive TV, ESPN broadband, games, ESPN high-definition TV. You can even see what's playing on all of the ESPN channels right now. And look at this, Marty. I've made the cover of ESPN Magazine. Mom, I'm famous.
Oh, my God. Look at this. We'll never hear the end of this, guys.
He's going to want a raise now.
Good luck. All right, Scott Collette has advanced. Can Doug follow? More on this matchup, but let's talk to Scott. He's with Bill.
I'm surrounded by two-time champions. Larry Dixon up in the booth, Scott Collette down here, and you were hauling the buns that time.
Yeah, doing okay. It was, he must have tried to spin the tires early because it kind of went apart, but we'll go back and fix it. And hey, you know, we just keep going rounds. That's all that matters.
Must have picked up in the back half, though.
Yeah, oh yeah, it did. It ran pretty strong in the back half, so we'll go back and work on it.
Fastest car in the history of the sport.
Thanks, Bill. You know, you were talking about championships. When you talk about Tony Schumacher, former champion, Kenny Bernstein, Scott Collette, three of the four that are in the semifinals for sure have won championships. We've got a two-time champion up here. I feel like a brown pair of shoes and a bunch of tuxedos.
I kind of feel like a brown pair of shoes, too, because they're out on the track and I'm in the booth.
Well, how do you think I felt for 2 years?
There's Corey Mack's numbers here in 2003. This car has either been very strong or it has smoked the tires early recently. That seems to have been their trend.
Well, you're definitely right. It's either feast or famine with them. But I tell you, John Stewart's done a good job. The car, when it does go down the track, runs some good numbers. And if they can get it stuck, they're definitely going to give Doug Collette a good race.
Blows it up. He cut a great light. In fact, he had 8 100s in the bank as Doug was caught napping a little bit compared to Corey's 0:27 light. But then he runs a 4:55 at 3:12. Take another look.
Yeah, I mean, Corey was definitely in a little bit deep, but still had a good light anyway. Doug, like you said, was a little bit late, but shortly after the car left, I couldn't see if there was a cylinder. You saw a cylinder go out there, but it was already starting to spin the tires. I think that's what put the cylinders out. Kind of similar to what we saw with you first round, Larry. It spun the tire, put the cylinders out, and then pushed either head gasket or a rod out the side.
And let's take a look at the matchups, because there is a potential Kalita family reunion if they both can advance past the semifinals. Tony Schumacher is going to have the lane choice by 3/100ths over Doug Kalita. Over on the other side, lane choice goes to Scott Kalita over Kenny Bernstein. When we come back, it'll be time. Wait a minute, is that Larry, Moe, and Curly, or is that Larry, Marty, and Mike? Stay with us. We're coming back. Delco Las Vegas Nationals. We're getting ready for Funny Card second round. Here are the matchups. Tony Pedregon has lane choice. So does Gary Selzy. Over on the other side, Frank Pedregon and Whit Bazemore. It's going to be that Jackson-Pedregon matchup that we're going to focus on first. Keith Jackson's in rarefied air. He's never gone past this point if he goes into the semifinals. For Frank Pedregon, well, he has something in common with you, Larry Dixon. Happy birthday last Thursday. Both of you born on October 23rd.
Hey, thank you very much.
He's 41 and you know,
I'm behind him.
Yeah, you're younger. Larry turned 37. And did you do anything special out here for your birthday?
Well, just went with my family. Went and ate dinner. Had some really good Italian.
All right. Let's set this matchup up. As you well know, Keith Jackson in the opening round. If you saw the highlights, Gary Densham went down when he smoked the tires, and Keith pulled off the upset, and his heart's got to be pounding right now.
Yeah, Keith Jackson's just got to be happy to be here. Frank Pedregon, on the other hand, they've been struggling. He's very happy to be here also, but the car's really starting to perform. They switched a PSI blower a few races ago, and it's taken them a while to get a handle on the combination, but this weekend the car's been looking very good.
You saw the anemometer there. Yesterday it was spinning so fast we couldn't even keep up with it. We had 30-mile-an-hour winds. Today it's been a lot calmer. Beautiful day, and what a spectacular crowd we've had here at the Strip at Las Vegas Motor Speedway. Getting ready for second round, Funny Car. Well, Frankie ends the dream for Keith. He gave it a good run at a 5.16, but Frank goes 4.96 at 293 miles an hour. Take another look, guys.
Yeah, I mean, both drivers left together, and then after 60 feet, pretty much Frankie Pedregon just pulled away and held on for the win. But I'll tell you, you know, Keith Jackson did a great job. Nothing to be ashamed of this weekend. You see he had a cylinder out on the right side of the car, and that slowed him down. Frank Pedregon, it looked like he might have kind of mixed up on the other end. Take a look. Tell me about this bump here.
It looked like when it hit the bump, it might have put a cylinder out.
Look at that. Boy, it's really bouncing there. When,
oh, boy.
There it goes. The cylinder. Yep. Got a little bit loose right there.
See right there.
Good job, Larry. First time on the Telestrator, you hit the mark.
You're hired.
You're in trouble. You're in trouble, Dunn.
We're going to switch jobs next year, okay?
Oh, there goes the
rumor
mill.
Wait a minute. You don't want this job?
All right.
I don't want to give up Dick LeHay.
I don't blame you.
Let's set the stage for you, because now is one of those crucial moments. Whit Bazemore, Lee Beard, they have got to win this round to stay alive in the championship chase. Bill Burkhart is the man in the way right now. Whit's going to be in the left lane, Burkhart over in the right. Larry, you've been on both ends of this spectrum, where you were trailing, where you were leading. Take us through it. What are you thinking about at this stage?
For Whit, you know, we talked about it, you know, like he was talking about earlier. His game plan is simple. He's just got to win. He's got to win rounds and hope that that Tony stumbles. That's his game plan. Just go out there and try and win the event. Win every round you're in and all that. And if chips fall your way, great. If they don't, you've done as much as you can do. On the other side, Tony, he'd be nervous. I mean, it's like you're walking on eggshells 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, 30 days a month. I mean, it's just, it's brutal. It's brutal. But, and you get into that routine and you don't know any better. You just react that way.
Let's get more from Dave Reed.
Very simply stated, I asked Lee Beard what it's going to take to win this round. He looked at me and said, well, if the dragsters are going in the 50s, we ought to be able to go in the 80s.
Well, we're going to find out as the body goes up. They'll make the final adjustments. Over on the other side, Phil Burkhart and this team, they have really gelled quickly. Look at this. Since he came on board, replacing Johnny Gray after Indy, 7 up, 6 down.
Yeah, they've looked very impressive. Mark Denner, Chris Cunningham, crew chiefs on that car, done a great job. Phil Burkhardt, I mean, I'll tell you what, he looked very good. He just got in this car and made it look effortless. Since he took over from Johnny Gray after Johnny Gray got runner-up at the U.S. National, this team's never looked bad. They're very consistent. But I'll tell you, Lee Beard there, right there, I got to agree with him. Mid-480, usually at the rule of thumb, 0.3 seconds slower, so he should be able to run a mid-80, hopefully.
A 486 at 312. The championship chase continues. Burkhardt runs 494 at 309, and I think there were some hearts beating awfully fast there when they saw that car go left.
Boy, you're exactly right, Mark, because we saw it in qualifying. Witt put a cylinder out, moved it over towards the wall, and spun the tires pretty good. But this case, I mean, he's had a little bit of trouble holding this thing in the groove, but as he went over the bump, there it is, right over there, moved way over the wall, out of the groove, but the car stayed stuck and ran the number that basically Lee Beard was looking for. 486, just a great pass.
The incrementals show you that Burkhardt was leading at 60 feet, but from half track on, it was all Bazemore. We got to take commercial break. John Medlin's going back underneath the hood. Tony Pedregon still to come. The opinionated Jim Rome is back on ESPN. He's not afraid of anyone, doesn't back down on any subject. Rome is Burning, presented by Coors Original, Tuesdays at 7 Eastern on ESPN. For more, log on to ESPN.com. Well, before we get to Tony Pedregon, it will be Tim Wilkerson and Gary Selzy coming to the line. And as they continue the backup process, let's talk to Whit Bazemore. He's with Bill.
Whit, looked like it moved around a little on you, but what a clutch performance, man. You got it to the stripe.
Yeah, it's a handful. It's ever since we had that tire problem in Sonoma, the chassis has been not quite new, and it's been hard. But, Bill, I got to say, our team was frustrated by a lot of the things you said this year about our team and what you wrote. But I want you to know and everyone else that the relationship I have with those guys means more to me than this championship, because we bonded this year. It's been a great year for this Matco Tools Dodge team. And no matter what happens from here on out, Tony, they're a great team over there. And it's just been tremendous. And I'm proud to be part of it. But I'm really proud of the effort those guys have made, because it's second to none. It truly is. So thank you.
Thank you. I guess you're not going to get a Christmas card, Bill. Here we go with this one. Selzy does his job. 490, 320 miles an hour. That puts him on a collision course with Tony Pedregon if Tony can win his next matchup. Tim Wilkerson runs 494 and gave it a good run, but Selzy had this one.
Yeah, I mean, Gary, another 028 reaction time. I mean, Gary's putting her in awfully deep, but that means deep stage in the car, and he's probably given up about 400 or 500 on the elapsed time, but he's getting a great reaction time as we watch here. You're going to see the car. Look at the middle of the lane on the right side of your screen. Gary Selzy didn't have the problem that Witt had. Didn't get off to the side quite as bad. Moved around a little bit on the other end. But this car was stuck pretty good. Mike Neff done a real good job. But look at that bump. I mean, it definitely moves that car around. But unlike Witt, it stayed in the middle of the groove. Still made a decent run.
And so now the pressure falls on the shoulders of Tony Pedregon. John Force.
And John Force.
Yeah. John saying, okay, I can't win this championship, but now my driver has to. Del Worsham is the next obstacle. And as the body comes down on Del, let's get more from Dave Reif.
Just like they did in round number one, John Medlin told me they were going back to a qualifying setup, a setup that was in the mid-480s once again. That is the tune-up they will try to use to get this round win.
What do you think here? I mean, you mentioned it, Larry. Right now, Tony's nerves are like tied up in knots when you're the guy that's being pursued, because every little mistake can mean the difference.
Yeah, you just got to go up there and do your thing, not try and do anything dumb, crazy. You just got to go up there, just try to be as natural as you can on the tree, keep the car in the groove, and hopefully everything goes your way.
And if you're Del Worsham, what are you trying to do right now?
Well, Del Worsham is just trying to win the race. I mean, obviously you'd like to take out Tony Pedregon, but his main objective is to win the race and try to move up in the points. And Del, he knows, he loves racing Team Force. He races them as hard as anybody, and he's just going to go out there and do the best job that he can.
Well, Del is able to move within 13 points of Gary Denchin for fourth if he can win this round. So there is money and Powerade points at stake. And with Bazemore at the far end, a very interested spectator in this matchup. For Dell, he was quicker with 490, but he was second off the line. John Force is breathing again. This championship march moves on, Dave Reif.
We saw a clutch performance by Whit Bazemore and a clutch performance by your man, Tony Pettregon, to get the whole shot at win.
Well, you know, I want to be honest. That's why Tony Pettregon has the value right now, and people looking at Tony Pettregon because he does the job under pressure. The kid went on a whole shot right there, and that could have been the championship right here and could be over this weekend.
Wonder where he learned that from.
I'm with crew chief John Medlin. John, it went straight as an arrow down the groove, but your boy Tony's the one that got the job done on that one.
Yes, sir. Tony won the race for us. Got some tough competition out there in front of us. Go back and see if we can tune it up a little bit, do a little better the next round. We still need to depend on that driver, though. He's doing a great job.
Marty?
Well, as we take a look at this, let me tell you, Gary Selz, he's going to have lane choice, guys.
Yeah, but I think the lanes are pretty even. But I'll tell you what, Tony Pettregon, like you said, did his job. 0.02 seconds advantage off of the starting line, and then basically never looked back. You saw the cylinders go out after he traversed over those bumps. Let's see if we can see it again. You can see the bumps right there. Actually, a little bit before the bump, and he put a cylinder out, and it almost cost him, but it wasn't quite enough real estate for Dell Worsham to drive around him.
The margin of victory, 0.11 seconds. John Force says, hey, I can get used to this. Well, at least for the remainder this year. And Tony coasts on out. We'll get a chance to talk to him as he gets closer to Bill. Let's check the semifinal matchups. We already told you, Selzy's got the lane choice in the first one. And over on the other side, Whit Bazemore over Frank Pettregon. Stay with us, Pro Stock. Here at the AC Delco Las Vegas Nationals, as you get one more look at Tony Pettregon winning second round run, and we've got to say so long to the champ. Larry, we'll see you in 2 weeks. Thanks for stopping by. Appreciate it.
Oh, hopefully you guys get to see me, and I don't have to, no offense, but hopefully I don't see you guys.
We understand.
You understand?
To that. Come on.
Nah, I won't. Okay. Hey, we got to go.
Once a year is good enough.
Okay, that's a fair deal. Let's go to the far end of Bill.
Watch Chris, he might catch on fire.
Tony yelling to his crew, you know, this morning you told us you wanted it to end today, and had it not been for your better reaction time, we'd be going to Pomona.
But we're going to fight till the end. I am not going to allow all of the media. It's great. It's good for the fans. It's tough on us racers, but got Forrest in my corner. He really knows how to inspire and motivate people. Automobile Club of Southern California and Castrol. And we got some Ford muscle that we're throwing out there, too. It scrubbed a lot of speed off down track, so it must have ran good to then. And I didn't hear him, see him, but I'm just glad it's going to be a tough semifinals. But, again, we got to keep fighting. That's all.
Hey, you like the stuff I write about you, right?
It's all good.
I'm 1-1.
All right, let's talk about Pro Stock Bike right now and show you what happened back in the first round, just in case you weren't with us. Gino Scali ended up taking the win. He was over in the left lane as you saw him traverse that very tricky bump that is there with the cross under. And also winning, Sean Gann in his matchup, and it sets up a showdown with another winner in the points chase, Angel Savoy. Angel took the win light in her race. She's in the left lane. These two meet. The loser is out of the championship hunt. One other guy has been eliminated. Reggie Showers was really laid off the line. It cost him dearly as he has now been eliminated in the championship chase. In Pro Stock, well, what else do we say? Greg Anderson lowers the track record to another 685. So he is still the man to beat in this class. So let's take a look now at the Pro Stock matchups in round number two. Greg Anderson and Dave Connolly have the lane choice on one side. Jason Line and Kurt Johnson over on the other. And the first matchup we will see will pit Jason Line, trying to go to his first ever semifinal, up against Larry Morgan, a guy who's been to the semis three of the last five races in the Mopar Dodge.
Larry Morgan's been definitely coming on strong. We talked about it since he's brought on Bob Glidden, been looking very good. But I tell you, Jason Line's got that Craig Anderson horsepower over there. This car's been running very good. He's looking to try to get into that semifinal.
Jason has lane choice, likes that right lane.
Interesting choice. Mostly everybody's been choosing the left.
Larry was first off the line, but here comes the horsepower. Jason drives around him, a 691. Boy, the Samuel Lightship gave you a great view of just how Jason got around him, 199 miles an hour.
Boy, this is a great shot. Look at Larry Morgan make shoots over towards the center. He got too much tire spin right there. He hit that bump, and the car really moved around, and that's where Jason Lyon went around. Watch there. He goes over the center line, goes over the bumps right there. It's going to get loose right there, and that's where Jason Lyon was able to hook it up and go by for the win.
That is just how close it was at the stripe between those two. And now as we come back to the line, Kurt Johnson with the AC Delco and the special KISS colors. He'll be over in the right lane. Taylor Laster will be over on the left side. And Kurt had lane choice. He also selected the right lane. So maybe he's seeing the same thing that Jason saw.
Well, I mean, even Larry Dixon mentioned that he thought that the left lane had a bigger bump than the right lane, except he thought maybe the rubber was a little bit better earlier in the run. Now, maybe the pro stock cars are seeing that that's not as big of an advantage, and they're taking the right lane. Now, although most of the guys in the first round took the left lane, except for Greg Anderson and Jason Lyon.
Think about this. Kurt Johnson's only raced now three times in an event where his father was also not in the show. Well, one of those times, back at Joliet, the spring race, he won in 2003 here, and in 2002 at Sonoma, KJ lost in round two. Don't know if there's any significance there, but we'll find out, because here we are in second round. Obviously, the professor has full time to work on that car and give it some attention. See if they can do it again. Laster first off the line. Uh-oh, but then he shuts it off. So Kurt is moving to the semifinals. He goes 689 at 199 miles an hour. So he has moved into the semifinals. He will have lane choice over Jason Lyon. Meanwhile, here is the work going on back in Tony Pedregon's pit.
I tell you, there's a lot of pressure there on this weekend, like we've talked about, but the pressure each round as he wins, the crew is starting to feel a lot better about themselves, and obviously they got to be feeling really good about their driver, getting that whole shot win when it was very, very critical. Dale Worsham, no slouch on the tree, definitely a tough driver. They did their job. Tony Pedregon did an excellent job and definitely deserves to be in the semifinal match.
Straight on in.
With Jake Coughlin. He will be over in the left lane. Okay. Dave Conley taking the right lane. Conley had the lane choice. It's the 12th pro stock race for Conley. He lost to Jake at Dallas in the semifinals. That's the only semifinal he's made. Jake also beat him at Memphis, Sonoma, and his first race ever back at the spring Chicago event. Dave Conley, the 20-year-old out of Elyria, Ohio. That's a little north of Jeg, who lives in Delaware. He'd like to get off the Schneid here and put Jeggy on the trailer for the first time in his career. Conley, first off. But Jeggy takes the win. 688 to a 690.
199.70. Beautiful run, bud. Felt real nice, man. Just moved around a little bit after we hit that bump, but felt like I got that dream done there, and motored on by. Good job, guys.
Jeg stepped up his performance from first round. Conley fell off a little bit.
Yeah, and that was big. You heard Jeggy say that thing moved around a little bit when it hit that bump, but not too bad. And that was the key, be able to get through there, because we're seeing a lot of guys have trouble at that point when they're going there down track about 300 or 400 foot, trying to make it over that hump.
Final matchup here in second round of Pro Stock. You're looking at Ron Krischer. He's not been to a semifinal since he won the race at St. Louis. Now, over in the other lane, well, it just happens to be Greg Anderson, who, well, the last time he was not in the semifinals was Denver. It's like, this guy has been next unbeatable. Look at the ET. That is a track record that he set in first round.
And he's amazing. I mean, he took the right lane when nobody was taking the right lane. We said that we didn't think there was much difference in the lane choice, but obviously, this is one of the things I like about Greg Anderson and Kurt Johnson. I mean, those kind of racers, they don't go with what everybody else is doing. They evaluate the track, they evaluate the situation, and make decisions based off of that. And for the most part, they're pretty much always make the right decisions.
to get. Lane choice over Jake Coughlin. Got to run quicker than a 6.88 with a 6. Anderson first off the line. And by a car length, he's going to have lane. Thousandth of a second. He's going to have lane choice over Jake Coughlin and moves into another semifinal matchup. Boy, we've seen these two locking horns a lot lately. We're going to get to see it one more time. And Kurt Johnson's going to have the lane choice over Greg's teammate, Jason Lyne. Pro Stock Bike. Oh, I could use some of that change. Stay with us. We're coming back to Las Vegas. Yes, part of the air show that you get, courtesy of Nellis Air Force Base, home of the Thunderbirds. It's right next door to the strip at Las Vegas Motor Speedway. We're here for the AC Delco Las Vegas Nationals. And as he's zooming in for a landing, let's go the far end to Bill.
Well, the number one will remain on Jed Coughlin's Chevy Cavalier for only two more weeks. And, Jeggy, what a difference from last year when you were wrapping up your title here. And this year, it just hasn't gone your way. But I know you're stoked for 2004.
Yeah, we are. And, you know, if we can keep this momentum we've had back in the R&D shop in Delaware, Ohio, going as we have. And, you know, we know Greg and his group and Warren and all the caliber of pro stock will be thrashing over the winter. But, you know, that's what we got in store for us. Our hats off to the whole Vegas General team and Greg. They've just had a banner season. They deserve to be champions, wear the number one for the 04 season. But we got a race today, and for the AC Delco fans, we're looking to shine.
And don't get the scraper out just yet. He's got it for a couple.
All right, thanks, Bill. Let's take a look at the matchups now in round number two of Pro Stock Bike. Craig Treble, Andrew Hines have the lane choice. And unfortunately for one of these two, Angel Savoie or Sean Gann, their title hopes are going to end because the loser is out of the chase. Gino Scali has the lane choice over Mike Berry. And that's going to be our first matchup again. Gino, he actually had the second choice this time and still wanted to go first again.
Yeah, I mean, like we talked about, maybe the first round he wanted to get it over with, because I tell you, Mike Berry's looked very, very good. I mean, he got runner-up at Denver, but really didn't have the form. He's got some breaks to get to the final round, but the last few races, the bike has started running very well. And all through qualifying, he's looked very good. Only ran 200 seconds slower than Gino in the first round.
Red light Scali, that is number six of the year, and this championship will go. So Scali, by 007, goes red, gives the win to Mike Berry. Let's check in with Parker.
Marty Geary says he's not only Whit Bazemore's teammate, they're also friends, and a lot being made about the semifinal matchup with you and Tony Pendragon and how it might affect the Funny Car Championship, Gary.
Well, I'm letting Bazemore worry about his own deal right now. I'm trying to move into six right now. I'm right on Caps' tail, and, you know, I haven't beat Tony all year long, and we need to do it. And the law of averages, if you race him enough, you're going to beat him, and that's our plan right now with the Oakley Dodge.
Every man for himself, Marty.
And as we look at a complete engine change going on in Tony Pedregon's camp, so obviously they saw something they didn't like.
Yeah, I don't know if that's their normal maintenance. Some of the teams actually will just change complete short blocks, or if they actually had some damage, like maybe possibly a spun bearing under there that made them have to change the engine.
Next up, out in the line, it's GT Tonglet and Craig Treble. And Tonglet will be over in the right lane, Treble in the left. There's that page scheme on the Matt Hines bike that Treble is using. Here we go, and another red light. Tonglet throws it away. 34% of the races this year in this division have been decided by red lights. It's number six for GT Tonglet, and it's a 7.23 at 184 for Craig Treble as he takes the win. Let's check in again with Bill.
You are bumming.
Yeah, I guess it is what it is. That's how I look at it. I guess the sun is getting going underneath the mountains, and it's getting a little bit darker out, and I hit the light like I normally would, and 007 red, I guess. It seemed to run pretty fast, went straight down the pipe, you know. I guess we got to wait to Pomona, California to see if we can wrap this up.
Oh, would he love to have that one back.
Absolutely, Bill. And you know, you've got 2 weeks to think about it, what might have been, and now what will be. Sean Connor and that man right there, Andrew Hines, one of the Harleys already down as a result of a red light. Hines will be over in the right lane. Connor, who had only his third round win of his career in the first round today, is looking to go to his first ever semifinal. Who's going to go in first? Connor. And again from the Sanyo Lightship. What a great shot that is. You get to see these guys literally just drive right around because Connor had the advantage off the starting line, but just too much horsepower. 187 miles an hour compared to 179. Back on the starting line. I'm wondering, is Angel having any kind of problem there? I can't tell for sure. It doesn't look like everybody. No, no problem. Sean Gann, Angel Savoie coming to the line now. And this is huge because the winner moves on. While they complete the process, let's quickly go to Dave Reif.
And down on the floor, you see the old bullet that has just been taken out of Tony Pedregon's car. As John Medlin and Dickie Venables talk about everything that's going on, I'm going to try to jump in real quick and get a word with John Medlin, if we can. John, what's going on down here? Big change.
Pardon me?
Big change is going on. That's an old motor.
Yeah, we've been using them up. The motor hadn't been overly happy that last run, so we just perked that one. We're going to put another one in.
Just, it's as simple as that, and as you said, they've got lots of them here.
All right, thanks, Dave. Remember, coming into today's action, into this round, Sean Gann trailed by 155 points, Angel 157. 138 is the magic number, so one of these two is going home, and it's Sean Gann. Gann is out of the championship chase with his sixth red light of the year. And he throws away a 7:33. Angel runs 7:29 at 181, and she cut an 0:72 light. So he could have had the difference. It could have been a hole shot for him. Instead, it is a red light. So the three-time champ is still alive. Lane choice in one semifinal goes to Craig Treble, and in the other to Angel Savoie here at the AC Delco Las Vegas Nationals. Stay with us. We're coming back with a lot more action here as the action continues back in the pits. Oh, he's taking some deep breaths. Playmakers continues Tuesday. One of the teammates is gay. Will the Cougars band together or come apart? Playmakers, Tuesday 9 Eastern on ESPN. It's available on high definition on ESPN HD. Call your cable operator, DirecTV, or Dish Network today. For more, log on to ESPN.com. Let's go to Bill at the far end.
Angel, now it's down to you and Gino Scali. We'll wait to the end of the day to see how much of a lead he'll have going to Pomona, but you were almost sunk before you started on that run.
Yeah, I had a little excitement there on the burnout. Well, we have to put our bikes in second gear to do the burnout, and I was having a little trouble getting it in gear, and I started to panic a little bit. We yelled for my crew chief. He came over, got the bike in gear for me, and I had a feeling that Sean was going to red light. He's been pushing the tree pretty hard. I'm just glad that I got down the track. I still have lane choice for the next round, and the U.S. Army Suzuki's going another round again.
There was a time when she would have been rattled by something like that, but a three-time champion now has the presence of mind to work through it.
Thanks, Bill. Now, just moments ago, we were telling you about what was going on in Tony Pedregon's pit. Look at them taking the motor out. They are in a major thrash, and that's the subject of today's Suzuki Track Fact. Track Fact brought to you by Suzuki, maker of innovative motorcycles and all-terrain vehicles.
And to be quite honest, it probably looks a whole heck of a lot more major than it is, changing out one of these things, because you totally have to strip the car down to the bare frame rails. But keep in mind that all of these pieces pretty much come pre-assembled. And if you're a member of John Force Racing, that means at your disposal at any one time, you probably have as many as 30 different motors to choose from. They are stored all over inside of all of the race haulers. Right inside of here, as Bernie Federle walks by, you can see there are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 just in this trailer alone. That's the benefit of being part of John Force Racing, and that's why Tony Pedregon, engine change, not going to be as major a thrash as it probably looks right here.
Well, it looks a little bit more difficult than I could do, Dave, but they are experienced, that's for sure. We come back, more from Las Vegas.
Don't
Don't forget, Monday Night Countdown starts at 7:30 p.m. on ESPN. Stuart Scott, Michael Irvin, Ron Jaworski, Tom Jackson, they've got all the latest news. And then we switch over to ABC because the Miami Dolphins, led by Ricky Williams, travel to San Diego to take on LaDainian Tomlinson and the Chargers. Monday Night Football, 9 o'clock Eastern on ABC TV. Time now for today's Powerade Profile.
People want to know what professional race car drivers do for fun away from the racetrack. Well, what they do is they come back to the racetrack. For Gary Selzy, Tommy Johnson Jr., and Ron Capps, they've left the drag strip and come to the road course. Some fans may be under the misconception that racers only enjoy their discipline. That is, drag racing is only for drag racers, road racing only for road racers. But in fact, race car drivers enjoy all forms of motorsports and absolutely relish the opportunities to climb into a different sort of car on a different kind of track. All right, Ron, first time in a larger formula car from your go-kart experience. What do you think?
They're awesome. Great cars. I mean, the balance, I was behind Selzy for a while, and obviously Selzy's a good driver, so yeah, I was following him for a bit, and then, you know, you don't want to get over your head, and you get out there, and you get the instructor up there, and they're going through the gears and stuff, and it doesn't look as fast when you're watching somebody else, but when you're in that car and you're that low, I mean, Selzy, he'll tell you, man, it's, you feel like you're going 320 down the straightaway.
For Tommy Johnson Jr., it's been 9-10 years since you were in cars similar to these at a professional driving school, and now being in a funny car over 300 miles an hour, what's it like to go back to these cars on a road course?
It was a little quick at first, you know, you go into these corners and...
No, whoa, a little quick? You go over 300 miles an hour, these go 110.
When I seen the turn coming, you know? Then it seemed a little quick. I didn't have a chute to slow me down, but getting used to the brakes and getting used to picking when to pick up the throttle and hitting the apex, as you would know. Give me all the tips before we started, but it took a couple laps, but then it was nice. It was smooth. It all come rushing back, just like riding the bike.
One thing that I've come to learn over the years is no matter what discipline of racing, whether it's Formula One, Champ Cars, drag racing, pro off-road rally, drivers have an appreciation for their brethren in the other forms of sport. And after watching these funny car drivers race around in these Formula cars all day, I've got no choice. I have to go. I was an instructor at a professional racing school for 8 years, and in that time, I watched thousands of students lap. And Ron, after watching you on Friday, I have to say, you're the real deal. You were going quick, and it looked like you were having a blast.
Yeah, anytime we can do that. We're lucky enough to be in this business to be able to go do the IROC or do midget race in the Chili Bowl or do that, and it's awesome. It's a completely different feeling, and, you know, people say, how can you take that and translate it? Well, a lot of what we learn over there is the hand-eye coordination, a lot of the feel of the car, like you and I talked about. And we, as funny car drivers, you have to really know how the car's feeling. And not only do we do that for fun, but I take that as a learning experience.
And it's important for these drivers to know how to turn left and right, because very rarely does a funny car go straight, Dave.
Parker, Kurt Johnson is not lacking for fan support this weekend. Shoot, he's got Paul Stanley, he's got Gene Simmons, and he's got this man. This is Dave Weave in the AC Delco shirt from Canada. He is one of 1,400 AC Delco employees in town for the national sales meeting. And more importantly, you're looking at the AC Delco Tech of the Millennium. He was one of 2,400 technicians who began a quest last October with tests and hands-on diagnosis and repair of Buick Centuries. He was one of 8 finalists who came here, and when it was all said and done, he was the big winner. How big a win? $200,000. Are you serious? It even gets Paul and Gene's attention.
Yeah, and he gets the girls there, too. That's a heck of a win. I mean, he's having a great time. I'm a little myself. Hey, stay with us when we come back. More from the AC Delco Las Vegas Nationals. Back here. Strip at Las Vegas Motor Speedway. You're looking down in the pit area from the Sanyo Lightship. Proud to bring us our spectacular shots from the Sanyo Lightship. There the guys are, hovering high overhead. A lot easier flying today than it was yesterday when the winds were whipping around 30 miles an hour. Thanks, guys. Let's check in now with Bill.
Well, Tony Schumacher and the U.S. Army Top Fuel Dragster and his tuner Alan Johnson have been feeding the rest of the class a steady diet of 450s this weekend. Qualified number one with a 450. Little off the pace in round one with a 462, but came right back in the second round with a 452. Alan Johnson says a bit more grip as it gets later in the day. Could see a high 440 out there, but Tony's going to be racing another 450 car, Doug Collette, in the semifinals. It's going to be like a Clemens and Pedro matchup, strength against strength. We're going to find out who can throw it the hardest.
All right, thanks, Bill. We're going to find out, because when we come back, it will be time for the semifinals in Top Fuel, Funny Car, Pro Stock, and the bike. Stay with us. We're coming back to Las Vegas. Strip at Las Vegas Motor Speedway and AC Delco Las Vegas Nationals. It has been one exciting afternoon of racing. Yeah, we've had a lot of celebrities here. Chubby Checker, Jesse James, and thousands of NHRA Powerade drag racing fans. Look at the grandstand. Best crowd we have ever had here at the Strip. And right now we're getting ready for Top Fuel semifinals. There's Brandon Bernstein ready to watch Dad go at it again with Scott Colletti. You know, the first time these guys ever raced each other was 17 years ago in Funny Car.
That's pretty amazing. Both of these guys are veterans of the sport, both in Funny Car and Top Fuel. They're very, very competitive.
Last time they met was the Dallas final when Kenny won. Debrief.
The general needs to tune the Budweiser King up. He knows that. The car smoked the tires early in the second round, and he needs to get it fixed. It needs to go quicker, earlier. That will be the key for Kenny Bernstein here.
Coletta's up in smoke. Bernstein's going to his third final in the last four races, and his fourth Las Vegas final in six Las Vegas races. Maybe we ought to rename this place. Parker.
I'm with renowned motorsports artist Sam Bass, who's responsible for the tremendous creation that you see on the side of Kurt Johnson's Pro Stock car this weekend. Sam, what was your inspiration?
Well, a couple of really good, colorful characters to work with, Gene Simmons and Paul Stanley. I've been a lifelong Kiss fan, and I'm the designer for AC Delco, so to get the chance to integrate Kiss and AC Delco together on this car was just a dream come true.
And how did you get all these design elements into one car?
Well, I just picked the black diamond as the centerpiece, and then the flames. When you got Gene blowing flames at the concert, you know, you got to have flames on the car. And I just tried to integrate their colors, you know, their aura colors into the design around their faces. And it turned out really, really cool.
This car looks fast not only on the track, but standing still.
It is a sharp design. Let's take another look as Kenny Bernstein goes 4.56.
Just what KB and Tim Richards were looking for, right down the middle of the lane. They didn't have lane choice. They were put in that right-hand lane. They'd spun the tires earlier in the left-hand lane. So obviously they're liking what they're seeing over there at 4.56. Good run. Look at Scott Collette. It went about 60 feet, then the tires started to shake, went right into tire smoke, and pretty much ended his day right there. Parker?
Saw big problems for Scott Collette. There may be big problems for Doug Collette. Scott Collette was late leaving the pits because they were making lots of last-minute changes. Uncle Connie found out at the last moment he had been looking at the wrong set of data, looking at Doug Coletta's car, making adjustments to Scott's car. Was vice versa true? It very well could be. Now, both of these cars are set up exactly the same, but there are idiosyncrasies because those two cars are exactly the same, Dave.
And here's a shocker. Talked with Alan Johnson about how he would approach this in the U.S. Army Dragster. He said he's going to have to step it up a little bit. He thinks that he possibly needs to go 4.49 or 4.50 to get around Coletta. This could be one of those hero or zero kind of passes.
Tony and Doug meeting for the seventh consecutive race.
In the last race in Dallas, they ran in the first round, and Doug Coletta put a big hole shot as Tony was dead late. I guarantee he's thinking about that, but he knows he's got a good car now. I don't expect that to happen. He's going to be safe, focused. The boy's going to be tough. Doug Coletta's a tough customer.
A couple of years ago when you came here with Tim Richards for the first time, you were just unbeatable that weekend, and this weekend ain't looking too bad either.
Well, so far it's great, and Tim again is doing a great job as always, and The Bud team, Lucas and Mac Tools, I tell you, just keep going at it hard as we can go. What a tough final we got with Schumacher. Those guys are just out in a stratosphere somewhere. I don't even know if it's out there. I don't know how far out it is, but it's a long way out there.
You've had some tough ones before.
Take a look at the matchup in the final. It'll be lane choice to Tony Schumacher in his sixth final of 2003 by 6/100ths of a second over Kenny Bernstein. When we come back, time for Funny Car Semifinals. The championship chase continues. Jim Rome, the opinionated one, is back on ESPN. Not afraid to tackle any issue or anyone. Rome is Burning, presented by Coors Original, Tuesdays at 7 Eastern. For more, log on to ESPN.com. All right, time for Funny Car Semifinals. Frank Pendragon, can he help his brother by punching out Whit Mazemore? And can Tony Pendragon take care of business as Gary Selzy tries to help his teammate? We're about to find out. And it will be Selzy and Pendragon up first. And with the lane choice, Gary Selzy has taken the left lane.
I'll tell you, Marty, this is a great matchup. I mean, Gary Selzy has a real good shot being able to take out Tony Pendragon. Mike Neff has found the problem. They had qualifying. They weren't running on the other end. But since a race day elimination, has been running over 320 miles per hour. That's going to be the key. But Tony Pendragon, he's been running good all weekend. This is a great matchup.
Parker?
Gary Selzy is not being underestimated by Tony Pendragon's crew chief, John Medlin. Moments before starting, he popped the box and made quick adjustments to the clutch timers as well as ignition timing. He said he had to step it up because he thinks these guys are going to go really fast, Dave.
He shouldn't take Gary Selzy lightly either. He's the fastest car in the funny car history. And Mike Neff says he's going to go ahead and load it up a little bit better. The sun is setting, the track is cooler, the air is fine. They know they need to go quick and fast, and Gary Selzy can do it.
Well, Gary Selzy is looking to beat Tony Pendragon for the first time in the last five times they've met. It's 4-0 in the last matchups. Tony holding the advantage, and right now this would be the biggest round win in Schumacher Racing if he could put Tony on the trailer.
You know, and Gary Selzy's been mowing the tree down. Even though he's been staging deep, he's been getting some very, very good lights. This is going to be a good race.
Oh, Selzy's up in smoke. It's 5-0. Force is loving it. A 488 at 310. Another big puff of smoke, but they can fix it. They're in the final for the eighth time in 2003, Dave Reif.
Now the pressure switches to the other team, John Force.
Yeah, it does. God bless these guys, Dickie Venables and man, I'm a little shook right now. This championship, it's harder now on me than it was when it was me. But I love Tony, and he's doing his game every round. He's proven he's a champion. He proved it last year, and God bless him. They're going to do it again, I hope. We'll see here.
It's getting to these guys, Parker.
John Medlin, I saw you make the last-minute adjustments to the car. You stepped it up a 488. You guys are making this look easy.
Boy, it certainly isn't easy. Our competition is tough. All I can say is hallelujah. We run one more round. We're looking forward to the next one.
We'll take another look at this run, and remember this, every other time this year in seven prior finals, when John Medlin has gotten that car there, Tony Pendragon has taken it to victory.
Yeah, look at Gary Selzy here. He smokes tires almost immediately, but he did an excellent job of backpedaling. Obviously, Tony Pendragon was long gone, but that'll win you some race when you get in a pedal contest.
Let's go to the far end, Bill.
The suspense is strangulating. We started talking about in the first round, would it be this round, and then the second round, and now Tony, we're going to wait to see what Whit does.
It's not going to come easy, and regardless of the outcome, we got by that round, and hey, I'm hoping he cooperates and gets beat, but if he doesn't, hey, as advertised, NHRA Powerade, we're going to bring you a good drag race.
What great irony. Remember what happened here last year between Tony and John Force.
I asked Whit Mazemore's crew chief Lee Beard if he was concerned about watching the fellow team car of Gary Selzy go up in smoke. He said absolutely not, because we don't have ours tuned up nearly that strong. Dave?
And for Big Jim Dunn, he is a cagey racer. He will not give one to Whit Mazemore. He thinks 490 is good enough, especially if Mazemore makes a mistake.
Frank Pendragon could hand the championship to his brother on a silver platter if he just wins this round. It's going to be tough. Whit's got the lane choice. Tony looking on from the far end. Here we go. Not over yet. Mazemore again went out of the groove close to the wall, but goes 486 at 317. He's got lane choice over Tony. So it comes down to the final, and Bazemore has to win it or the championship is over for 2003.
Boy, Marty, this was just a good side-by-side run. I'll tell you, Lee Beard and that team did what they had to do. Like you said, Whit Bazemore got this car over to the side a little bit as it picks that left front wheel up there. Got her a little bit out of the groove, but he reels it back in right there. Got her stuck, didn't lose too much time, and still made a great pass to run a 486 at over 317 miles per hour.
Let's go to Parker.
Lee Beard, 486. Now, you told me just before that run that you had it backed off compared to Gary Selzy.
Well, we would run 86 around before. We had just left it alone there. We're trying to be smart, you know. But, hey, man, hats off to the Matco team. You know, it's going to be a classic battle between our team and John Force's team with Tony Pedregon over there. They're a fantastic team. They're going to be tough to beat, even though we have lane choice. We got our hands full, but you know, this is what people want to see.
They're still alive, and he did it Lee Beard style with hammer all the way down, Marty.
I'll tell you what, this is going to be fun to watch. You don't want to miss this. Tony wins, championship his. Whit wins, it goes to Pomona in 2 weeks. Pro Stock, when we come back, that's right, Factory Hot Rods. Stay with us. We're coming back to Las Vegas.
We're back at the AC Delco Nationals in Las Vegas, and the semifinals of Funny Car just completed, and Whit, we kind of had a feeling it was all going to come down to you and Tony eventually.
Yeah, eventually, and I guess it has for us. I mean, it's if we don't win the final, I guess that's it, right? Is that how it goes? So, you know, it's... heck, same as working for Don Schumacher all the time. You know, if you don't win the final, that's the way it goes. You're down the road, pal. So, we, you know, it's nothing new for our team and Matco Tools, but, you know, he's got way more to lose than we do. I mean, we're just trying to stay in the fight, and he's basically got it almost won, but almost is a long way from a done deal, and we've seen it all year like that.
He was right on this racetrack in April, but Whit raced Tony in the final round in the spring race and fouled up.
We come back to the starting line now. Factory Hot Rods, Pro Stock. There is Kurt Johnson. And you heard the story of how the design came about for the KISS AC Delco car. And as he backs up, Jason Line will be on the other side. Let's get more from Dave Reed.
Lots of busy work in Kurt Johnson's pit during the change between rounds. As these cars feature five-speed transmission, fifth gear in these cars is direct drive, which means you can change four gears. Kurt Johnson changed four gears before his semifinal matchup. Pretty radical.
It sure is, Dave. And for Greg Anderson's crew chief, Rob Downing, they're relatively new to running two cars. They've never had two cars in the semis. I asked them if this complicated things. He said, oh, yeah, but in a good way.
Well, Jason Line, of course, in uncharted territory for him, looking to go to his first ever final. For Kurt, he's looking to go to his ninth just of this year alone.
There'd be nothing better to make it in the final for Kurt Johnson and his sponsors, race AC Delco, sponsoring this team for a number of years, and he'd definitely like to be able to get in the final round. But I tell you what, Jason Line would like nothing better than to get in his first final and be up against his boss. That's what he's hoping for.
Well,
a couple things have to play out for that to happen.
That's for sure. If it did happen, it'd be the first Pro Stock all-team final since 2001. More on that first. Let's find out if he can make it. Here we go. A 690 to a quicker, but losing 688. It was Kurt's reaction time, his fourth time this year that he has won on a hole shot.
Yeah, Jason Line was just late here, 099. I mean, Kurt basically had 4.5 hundredths of a second off the starting line. There's a margin of victory over just about a half a car length there. Let's watch Kurt right down there. Got a little off sideways off of the starting line, but didn't look too bad. Still, I mean, went down the racetrack, ran a 690. Wasn't the perfect run, maybe not the right gear changes they were looking for. They'll try to make some adjustments for the final.
Lane change going on. Greg Anderson was in the right lane. That's where he's been all day, and now he's going over into the left lane where he just saw his teammate run a 688 in a losing effort. Jake Coughlin, without lane choice, has no say about it. He's going over into the right lane. Let's quickly go to Bill.
On a hole shot.
Absolutely awesome. You know, we've been having 60s and 50 lights, but you know what? Those aren't red like a few races we've had lately. But the AC Delco Cavalier, actually, it felt like it broke a valve spring or a rocker arm or something. When I put it in high gear, it just went flat. It felt like it got a bird on the carburetor or something. But hey, to come here, and if we could just win this race for AC Delco, KISS, everybody involved, Chevrolet, man, it would be awesome.
Kathy, pick up your outfit.
Let's go to Parker.
Jay Coughlin Sr. is not present this weekend, but very much a part of this team via cell phone. Remember, they didn't get into this field till the fourth session of qualifying. They found that they had added lots of test parts. Jake Sr. said, take all of that off the car, go back to what you know, and you should be fine. But Jake Coughlin Jr. knows if it's going to happen, it pretty much better happen at the hit of the throttle at the tree, guys.
Well, I guarantee you Jake's thinking about that, because Jake fouled out to Greg in the final at Dallas last time these met. That's only the fourth time he's gone red in 356 rounds of racing. And he also knows he can deny Greg a chance at pro stock history if he takes him down here. Jake 691 at 199. That's the slowest Jake has gone all day long. And boy, Greg Anderson, I guarantee you, when he talks to Bill, he's going to say, oh my gosh, I think we touched a bullet.
Man, I'll tell you, Greg Anderson, though, he just keeps making the right calls. First round, he moves over to the right lane, runs low ET. Then he sees something, he chooses the left lane and runs 686. I mean, this team is just in the zone. They've been that way all year. They've won the championship, and they deserve it. That's a great team.
And it's going to be a rematch of the Indianapolis final between Greg Anderson, who's going to have the lane choice, over Kurt Johnson. Remember, if Greg wins the race, that's number 10 or 11. He can break it, making it number 12. It'll tie with Darrell Alderman with 11. 12 would give him the single-season win mark. There's only 23 rounds of racing. Now, as we get ready for Pro Stock Bike, you're already looking into the eyes of Mike Berry, the sun setting off into the distance here at the Las Vegas Motor Speedway. And let's talk to Greg Anderson as we wait for these two bikes to come to life.
You know, Jack Coughlin won 10 races back in 2000, and he knew that you were on your way to perhaps breaking that record, so he just slapped a 005 light on you, but you waxed him anyway.
I can't say enough about my engine department. That is what's done it all year for me. I've drove around so many guys, you know. I try to buckle down, do a good job of driving, but you can't red light. That's an automatic loss, especially with the power I've got. So got to depend on it. You just quit. You buckle down. You try for them 20s and 30s, and hopefully that's enough. And it was today, but it's a great day, man. These Goodyear tires are hooked out there today. I'm having fun. It's a ball to drive. The Vegas General Construction car is in the final in Las Vegas. One more to go.
Now we turn our attention back to the starting line, where you can see the numbers on the elapsed times, the top five. Mike Berry and Angel Savoie both in there. Savoie, of course, the runner-up at Maple Grove to Mike Phillips. That was her last final round appearance. Mike Berry's only ever been to one final. That was Denver. He's first off the line. First to the stripe, 7:26 at 184 miles an hour. She cuts another 20 points off of Gino Scali's lead. And as she coasts on out, we'll get ready for more action. Back in Tony Pedregon's pit, looks like we're doing another complete engine turnaround.
Yeah, I mean, you know, they've been hurting at every run. You saw a lot of smoke out of the engine at the end of the run. But I tell you, they don't care at this point. They got plenty of bullets in the trailer like we saw, and they'll just keep plugging them in.
Meanwhile, this is the maintenance going on over in Whit Bazemore's pit.
Yeah, it looks like a little bit different. I don't think they possibly changed the block if, you know, servicing the engine inside the block. You know, and that's the thing. You know, some of the teams do that. Not so much anymore. A lot of them will service them completely in the block. They only change them if there's any damage.
So as we come back to the starting line, Angel already in her 48th career final now. Who will she face? Will it be Craig Treble or Andrew Hines? Ironically, Craig Treble's on Matt Hines' bike, Andrew's brother. And Andrews going to have words for Craig. A new track record on Brother Matt's bike, 7:16, a new elapsed time record, 1:85. And Craig Treble will have lane choice over Angel Savoie in the Pro Stock Bike Final. Stay with us. Delco Las Vegas Nationals, and we have narrowed the fields down to two in our four professional categories as we get ready to head that way. Let's put a period on Pro Stock Bike. Here's Bill.
With Angel Savoie, who knows the long shot for the championship, maybe out of reach, maybe not mathematically, but realistically, you just want to win the race.
I just have to thank the Lord for getting me this far. I mean, I've had a lot of stuff on my mind, a lot of things going on with our team. You know, we're struggling with Antron's bike, but my U.S. Army Suzuki is performing. They tell me I got to race this little guy on a pink bike in the final. I heard he went fast, but, you know, anything can happen, so we'll see.
The little man on the pink bike is Craig Treble, your low qualifier. A 7:16, a collective gasp just came out of the audience.
This is the fifth pass I've ever made on this motorcycle. And guess what, Bill? I think we found what it wanted. And just for the record, it's future, not pink. I got to thank the Vance and Hines guys. You know, we raced GT in the second round, Andrew in the third round, but this is Matt Hines' bike from last year. It's been sitting around in the shop up there in Trinidad getting cobwebs on it. And, you know, we've been struggling a little bit with our new Cosman piece, which will be back out soon. But in the interim, they wanted to put us on something so we can at least gain some dignity and show Mac O'Toole's a good show and all of our distributors. So, plus it's a Nitro Fish bike, too. Those guys dig it. So we're having a good day.
Not a bad idea riding the bike of a three-time Pro Stock Bike champion.
That's for sure, Bill. As we look at some of the thrashing going on, think about this. Team Schumacher could pull off the first ever triple in three pro divisions. Let's find out more what's going on. Dave Reif.
One of the teams that wants to stop that is Tony Pedregon's team, as there is a little bit of hop in each one of these guys' step as this championship gets ever, ever closer. They know by beating Whit Bazemore, they will take home the championship to California. You talked about another motor change. Indeed, that is the case. Talk to John Medlin. The car dropped a cylinder 4 seconds into that run, burned a piston. There are shaved metal particles all inside the block that just came out of this car. It's John Medlin, Dickie Venables, working on the race car. They will have it ready for the finals, guaranteed. To Parker.
And Dave, you may not believe it, but it looks like business as usual down in Whit Bazemore's pits. Everyone very calm, very composed, and like any top team, it's about changing components during the turnaround. So things here, you'd think that it's just another day at the job for these guys. The thing that I was flummoxed about is that they ran a 486, but they have to do what is instinctive. They can't change their game plan now. Stay tuned for more great racing action from Las Vegas.
ESPN Original Entertainment's Playmakers continues Tuesday at 9 Eastern on ESPN. Playmakers is also available in high def on ESPN HD. Call your cable operator, DirecTV, or Dish Network today. For more, log on to ESPN.com. Let's check in with Dave Reif one more time.
8 years in the making, the championship for Tony Pedregon. And Tony, how deliciously ironic that the guy you had burn downs, stare downs, practically throw downs with is the guy, the final domino you have to topple to get the title.
Maybe if we had known it was going to come to this, neither of us would have shot our mouths, but that's part of the excitement. Very big contrast in personalities, and I think that's kind of one of the things that's made up this a good storyline. And pretty ironic that it does come down to one race. And again, they're a good team. All is fair in love and war, but we're gonna try to roll them up.
You know, a lot of people thought John Force would never let this man win a championship. He's not letting him. He is flat earning it, Parker.
Dave, to stay in the Powerade Championship, Whit Bazemore is doing what he must do, go rounds. But Whit, don't you wish it were 6 o'clock at Pomona and this whole thing were over?
Well, actually, Parker, I don't, because I'm having fun. But, you know, it's been a great experience competing for a Powerade Championship. But, you know, right now we're way behind. I mean, they've had a great day. And if we can win, it'll just prolong Pedregon's agony for another week and another 2 weeks and make this 2 weeks more miserable for him than if he is already wearing the ring. So we have a little motivation there. But, you know, it isn't over till it's over. And we've seen some crazy things happen this year. So we're fighting, and we're not going to give up.
Saying it with a smile, guys.
Thanks, Parker. Time for the finals. Craig Anderson in Pro Stock. Kurt Johnson going to be side by side. Craig Treble and Angel Savoie will be the first matchup that we'll see here at the Strip at Las Vegas Motor Speedway. Here's how Angel got to the road of the final. And lead. Over in the left lane, it will be Craig Treble. Let's get more from Parker.
The underdog, Angel Savoie, speaking with the crew chief, Mike Pizer. Mark Pizer, he realizes they've thrown everything at this bike, and they don't think they have enough, so it's all up to Angel at the start line, Dave.
It's been a long season for both of these competitors, and for Craig Treble, he has changed absolutely nothing in that Vance and Hines-powered machine. He's hoping to go in the teens again here to get a win.
Treble looking to win his first race of 2003. And he's done it. 7:17, 185 at a 7:23 for Angel, and we will not have history because Don Schumacher had three entries in the finals, and so far one is eliminated. Angel moves to within 117 points. Gino Scali can wrap it up 2 weeks in Pomona. Let's take another look.
Boy, Marty, I tell you, Craig Treble and that team definitely found something in the semifinals. They carried it over to the final. Had a great light off the starting line. 0:28, left on Angel by just a little bit, who had a good light also. But that 7:17, that was just way too much for Angel at that point. He really got a handle on that bike and made some great passes the last two rounds.
Let's go to Bill.
Hey, Craig Treble, nothing like a used motorcycle, huh?
I'll tell you what, Bill, that was a little bit overdue. Man, I can't say enough about the Vance and Hines guys. They graciously gave me this awesome machine. I mean, it's unbelievably fast. And, man, I wish we would have had it at sea level. We'd probably be $10,000 richer. But, hey, you know what? We'll take it. Matco Tools, all of our distributors, finally get to pay those guys back. They go out there and work their butts off. And we do, too. But, you know, this is something special for those guys. And, man, I appreciate each and every one of those guys. So, hey. We're going to party down here in Las Vegas tonight, I promise you.
That's a racer who's usually going for the championship this year, seventh in points. Not the year he wanted, but still, he'll go away with a win today.
And Bill with the win, he actually moves up into sixth in the championship points chase. Time now to focus on Greg Anderson's quest to tie Darrell Alderman with 11 wins in a single season. The man standing in the way, number two in the points, behind the new champion. Johnson, there he is coming at you in the AC Delco Kiss car. Let's get more from Dave.
And for Kurt Johnson, he flat knows he is overpowered today by Greg Anderson. Hoping for a low 80, maybe around an 82. More realistic, probably looking at about an 85, 86, which means his only chance probably at knocking down Greg Anderson is cutting down the tree and hoping it falls on Greg.
Dave, one driver that could be distracted this weekend is Greg Anderson. It's team owner Ken Black's home race. They ran two cars, something they normally don't do. Lots of friends, family, and employees out to cheer him on. But it's that win record for most wins in a pro stock season that has this team focused, Marty.
Well, there's a graphic on the screen right now that says it best. Look at the laps times. I mean, he's just been crushing the field. And think about this. This is the fifth time these two have hooked horns in a final. Greg's won all four prior matchups.
Yeah, and it's basically that horsepower. That car runs awfully good. Kurt Johnson knows that he's going to have to cut a good light here if he's going to want to have a shot at it. Hopefully get the setup, don't spin the tires too much, and see what happens.
Team owner Ken Black at your home race, number one qualifier, another track record, and you've tied for most wins in a single season in pro stock. It's a perfect day in Las Vegas.
Just like Christmas. I mean, this is great. In front of I got a whole bunch of employees right up here. I don't know if you can get them on the TV or not. We've got people up in the boxes. I mean, this is great. I love it.
Congratulations.
Thanks. Appreciate it.
Take a look at the incrementals and the speed, 201.73, a new track speed record as well.
Well, and obviously Greg Anderson needed it. He was dead late off the starting line. Kurt Johnson had a good light, 0:35, but boy, it was that horsepower from Greg Anderson on the top end that got the win by that amount.
Let's go to Bill.
Greg Anderson for 11 years, as he receives congratulations from Tom Pacey from AC Delco and the trophy. For 11 years, you worked side by side with Kurt Johnson. He gave you a run for the championship this year. He was the only guy who could keep you from that 11th win of the season, and you still came through.
I don't know where to start. I am the most fortunate man in the world. I just can't imagine how God keeps shining on me. Everything I do is turning up roses. I got so many people to thank. Ken Black, Kenny Black Jr., Judy Black, Corey Black, thank you so much for the opportunity. I'm completely speechless. Nobody should be this fortunate in life, I don't think. You know, I'm just, I don't know what it is I've done right. I guess I live a clean life, but to be rewarded like this is just incredible. And I just thank so many people. And Brittany and Cody, I wish you guys were here, and I miss you, and I love you, and I'll see you tomorrow. Just enjoy.
And we've got to take a commercial break. When we come back, two decided, two to go. The AC Delco Las Vegas Nationals at the Strip at Las Vegas Motor Speedway. And it's time now for the finals in Fuel. And it is Tony Schumacher, Kenny Bernstein squaring off. Tony Pedregon against Whit Bazemore, the championship on the line here at Las Vegas. And there is Lee Beard bringing his Matco Tools car, the Dodge Hemi, to the line. And throw out all the other records. Throw out all the other statistics. What this really comes down to is Tony wins. He takes home the title. Parker?
I spoke with crew chief Lee Beard, overseeing the shots for Whit Bazemore, and this is an all or nothing call. He's going for the juggler, going for the throat. Either it's going to be low ET, a big speed number, or it's going to be smoke, guys.
Some final changes to Tony Pedregon's car, some changes to the chips and the ignition as these guys try to duplicate their qualifying effort. Keep in mind, this is a team that went 6.75 twice. As I said, a very delicious final here. A couple of guys haven't got along very good this year.
Yeah, I think both of these are very good calls. Obviously, Tony, if he can just go back and run his 4.75, he didn't qualify. The conditions look like they will hold it. Lee Beard, on the other hand, obviously has to stand on that thing to try to compete with, stay, you know, with that 4.75 run. If we don't see tire smoke, this could be a good race.
That plane has won 10 times today out of the 14 prior races, with Bazemore as the left lane.
You know, both drivers have been on all day long. They just got to do the same thing. They've been cutting good lights. They've been keeping the cars down the racetrack. Haven't seen any weak points in either one of the drivers. And they both got to do the same thing and see what happens.
You don't think? This butterflies in my stomach. I can't imagine what's going through theirs.
I've seen you put in tireless, long hours. The dream has been realized for John Force Racing once again, and more specifically, you and Tony Pedregon. Congratulations.
Well, thank you very much. Those long hours, is every nickel of it's worth it. We've got a tremendous team. These guys worked their hearts out. We've had some adverse conditions and positive results. It can't get any better than this. We're thrilled to death.
Congratulations, Joe.
And as you finish up, Parker, Whit Bazemore goes over to congratulate an obviously emotional Tony Pedregon at the top end of this racetrack.
two fantastic pedal jobs here, Mike.
Well, Marty, we saw tires smoke, and we still saw a great drag race. Both cars smoked the tires pretty much about the same point. They had about the same numbers to the 330. Right about there, Tony was actually a little bit quicker. Then they both started to spin the tires, had the back pedal. Tony got a slight advantage, a little bit better job right there. There's a quick pedal job, two of them actually. With Baysmore, there's a margin of victory at the other end. Great race, 513 to 518. Watch Tony Patrigan pedal this race car. He's going to do two quick pedal jobs. The car leads good, 60 feet. You're starting to apply the clutch now. It's moving good to 330, but then it's going to start getting loose right there. He pedals it once, starts spinning again, gets out of it one more time, gets it to kind of recover, kind of spinning the tires down there. Not quite as bad as Whit Baysmore, and he gets the win. Great job.
Let's go to Bill.
Tony Patrigan, you're a champion.
Thank you, Bill. A couple of people didn't realize it would actually happen this fast, but sorry to get emotional, but a couple of people, special people that have stood behind this team, Peter Miola from Castrol, North America, Dan Davis from Ford Racing, Bill Ford Jr. from Ford Motor Company, all the partners, MBNA, MacDoll, Goodyear, Automobile Club of Southern California, Tom McKern, and really is a special moment for me to join my brother Cruz as a champion. I hope we make a very good Powerade champion. It wasn't for them and everything they do for this sport, and it sure was exciting. It takes its toll, and it is not without a price, but I wish my daughter and my sweetheart, I love Andrea, she knows that, I wish they were here, but we'll join them in Pomona, and thank all the fans for all the support. Baysmore's a good guy. He's a tough competitor, and I knew at the end of this, at the end of the road, thank goodness there's a light at the end of the tunnel, but I'm speechless, Bill. This is an exciting moment. Thank John Forrest and this team. I didn't do it by myself. John Medlin, Dickie Venables, there's another 8 or 10 guys that helped on this car, and we all did it together, and it is a great feeling.
Tony, is there anything you can tell us about your future plans?
No. Right now, my future plans are I'm gonna squeeze the heck out of Medlin, and something might fall off of him, but I want to spend the time tonight and maybe in the next week and a half and gear up for one more race. We've got another weekend coming up in Pomona, the finale of excitement, and after that, heck, no hurry. I'll decide later. Right now, I'm going to try and enjoy this.
We have seen history made here in Las Vegas today.
As you see, the celebration continues. Take another look at Tony Patrigan.
You know, great job by both teams. Whit Baysmore got a slight hole shot off the starting line, but then they started spinning the tires both at the same time. Watch Tony Patrigan. He obviously used it up and caught on fire at the other end. Was definitely had the rods out of it from backpedaling and trying to get that thing stopped. Look at that. Sliding in his own oils. He's on fire pretty good there. And they've been hurting it all day, but I guarantee you they could care less. They're the Powerade champion, and they could... They don't care at this point.
In 14 years, two guys other than Force have been champions in funny car. They're both named Patrigan. Oh, yes, he can. Tony Patrigan wins for the fifth time in five finals. After finishing second in the standings four different times, Tony Patrigan can now be called Funny Car Champion. The 38-year-old appeared in eight finals, won all eight of them. He motored his way to six number one qualifying spots, led the points for all but three races this year. Tony Patrigan, the 2003 Funny Car Champion. Of the third running of the AC Delco Las Vegas Nationals, brought to you by Powerade. AC Delco Automotive Parts, when the right way is the only way. And Suzuki, maker of innovative motorcycle scooters and all-terrain vehicles. That is Hoover Dam, and that guy feels bigger than Hoover Dam right now. Let's go to Bill.
Whit, as you pointed out earlier today, you and I have had our differences, but I want to tell you right to your face that there's nobody that doesn't respect what you and your team did this year to chase this championship.
Well, I appreciate that, Bill. You know, it's as much a long shot as it was coming in here. The disappointment's huge, but it's more for the guys. You know, I mean, I'm fine. But the guys, they made such a huge effort, and we'll be there next year for sure.
Yeah, we believe that.
And congratulations.
Congratulations to both these teams. This was a great championship battle to watch. One more race to go. Tony Schumacher, Kenny Bernstein. Oh, Schumacher explodes and Bernstein wins. 454, 326 miles an hour. And it is his 68th career win, 38 now in Top Fuel.
A little bit of an upset there, Marty. I'll tell you, I didn't expect that. Tony Schumacher, even though Kenny Bernstein had about 200ths of a second advantage off the starting line, Tony Schumacher was on a run. He went 212 to 330. He was 400ths of a second quicker to that point for Tony. Watch this. This car launches hard. 832 and 60 feet, 212 and 330. Then you're going to see it go away right at this, right about that point there. End of his day. Tough break.
Kenny Bernstein, the first time you came to Las Vegas with Tim and Kim tuning your car, you won the race. And now the last time you're here, you won the race.
Well, again, you said the right words. Tim Richards, the best out here, and Kim, the whole Budweiser team, Lucas Oil. I can't say enough for them. I say it every time, but folks, I mean it from my heart because they make it happen. Can't say enough for it. And Mac Tools and all the people with us, my buddies at La Paz, Champion Sparkplugs, Borla. I mean, all those guys are great. And we got some guys here from Harley Davidson up there in Seattle. We like a whole lot too. Russ, Tom, and those boys. And AC Delco, we thank you so much. And Powerade, believe me, it's all part of this game. Had a great day. That's a tough race team over there. I expected them to go 46 or 7. And I don't know. I know Timmy had it in there, but something obviously was sour at the end down there.
This farewell is turning out to be a little better than last year's.
And we've got one more stop, and that'll be in Pomona in 2 weeks. There is our schedule of air times. Hope to see you then. We'll have more on Tony Petragon at 11:30 p.m. Eastern time tonight on RPM Tonight with host John Kernan. For Mike Dunn, Bill Stevens, Dave Reif, Parker Johnstone, and our entire ESPN2 crew, I'm Marty Reid. If you missed any of the action, coming up next is an encore presentation of the AC Delco Las Vegas Nationals. This has been a presentation of ESPN, the worldwide leader in sports. For more, log on to ESPN.com. We'll see you 2 weeks for Pomona. So long, everybody.